did he simply join you afterwards? You were already starting it, or a month ago after you met,
we started it January 2.
You started it January 2?
January 2,
so
yes.
Prior to meeting Congressman Garbin a month ago, you were not doing anything yet?
We were, but it was talking about it, and I told them about my experience, that so, I launched it before and all that.
Sino po ang naghingi ng meeting nung nag-meet kayo? Siya po nanghingi ng meeting o kayo po nanghingi ng meeting?
No, this was several parties, several dinners, and some...
So you met socially?
I volunteered the information that I know something about People's Initiative because we tried it before.
And you volunteered that information because he said he was interested in pursuing
it. And then I said, we can try it again because it's been my advocacy for the past 28 years, and why not?
When was this party, sir, and where was the place that you met and discussed that, and then you finally...
This was several parties, several...
San po?
Ibang lugar eh. Ibang lugar. Mm.
Kasama po ba sa lugar na yon ang Kongreso o ang bahay ng speaker?
Hindi naman. Pero you know, I know a lot of people in the political circles, in the social circles, in the business circles.
Hindi po yun ang tinatanong ko.
Senator Cheese, if you will allow, in the news article sa PhilStar, Mr. Oñate admitted that the conveners of the People's Initiative coordinated with congressman. Anong ibig sabihin ng coordinate? Sino ba ang pasimuno o kayo?
Yeah.
I'm a little bit confused. You're now saying January 2, but earlier you said it was Attorney Garbin who called you. Sino ba tumawag kanino?
Ako po ang nakipag-coordinate sa mga congressmen because according to the law, we are supposed to get 3% per congressional district.
Yes, we're
so
more
interested... So dahil 3% per congressional district, yung distrito na yon, a congressman ang leader doon sa Kongreso.
So who? Who are these congressmen? Senator Cheese and I would like to know, who are the congressmen that your group coordinated with? Tinawagan ninyo o sila tumawag?
Ako ang nakipag-coordinate.
Madam Chair, so, under oath, you admit that you coordinated this PIRMA initiative with congressmen since the 3% is required to be obtained per district.
Yeah, per district, yeah. That is
sino,
the requirement.
Tamang mo naman kami ng pangalan. Ay, sorry, Chief. Go ahead.
So, tamang strategy naman yun. Sasangayin naman ako. Kuha ko ho yung nasa kalagayan ninyo, per district nga naman, ko-coordinate ko talaga sa congressman po yan dahil para makuha yung 3%. Let me digress a bit, Madam Chair. Because kababayan ko tong si attorney, that's why I refer to him as Congressman Garbin, because he used to be a party list representative of the party list Ako Bicol, which happens to be the same party list of the distinguished appropriations chairman of the House of Representatives. And in your various Facebook posts, I see you often in the House, Congressman Garbin. I presume you are a consultant of... Congressman, Chairman, Appro Chair Zaldico?
I serve as the Executive Director of Ako Bicol Party List. So I work with Ako Bicol until now.
But I see your pictures in most of the meetings in the House, Congressman Garbin, with the Speaker, not only as Ako Bicol Chairman. Which I...
That is true. That
pinapalo ka si kita sa Facebook eh.
That is of public knowledge. Mm-hmm. That you can... browse my Facebook, talagang puno ng pictures ng House dahil nagtatrabaho po ako sa Ako Bicol Party List, which happens to be ang isang representante ay chairman ng Committee on Appropriation.
Just to settle that fact, Madam Chair. Now, proceeding with the question of the chairperson, Mr. Oñate, you said you contacted congressmen to get the 3% per district. Nasabi ko nga, kung ako din yung nasa kalagayan yung sinusulong to, kukontakin ko rin yung congressman dahil per district ang usapan, di naman per barangay eh. Di ba? Per district ang usapan, di naman per munisipyo eh.
Yeah,
so, papunta rin sa tanong ni Senator Aimee, Chairman Aimee, sino po yung mga congressman na kinontak po ninyo na umuopo sa inyo, na tutulungan kayo na makuha yung 3%?
Kaya naman namin naisip na lumapit sa mga congressmen is...
Yung mga pangalan na lang po, please. Marami po pa tayong testigo. Si nandito na
Congressman
si Justice Rufus Carpio.
Rodriguez, at kinausap namin si Congressman Garvin, kinausap ko.
Sino ba po? Sino ba po?
Sina Congressman Saldico kasama at si Speaker Romualdez?
Saldico, no, I didn't talk to Saldi. Saldico.
Ganun po ba? Sigurado po kayo kasi marami-rami ang meeting ninyo, mga party, dinner. Sabi nga ninyo, ilang beses kayo. Sigurado kayo wala si Speaker, wala si Congressman Saldico sa anumang pagtitipon?
Madam Chair, in all the meetings that transpired, none of the presence of Congressman Saldico and Speaker Maldes was there. They were not there. Ako naman, nilapitan ni Mr. Oñate because he knew for a fact that in the 18th Congress, I was the chair of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments who defended the resolution of both houses number 2 passed the restrictive economic provisions of the Constitution.
With due respect to Congressman Garbin, may we just recognize the chairperson because they're flashing a very important picture on screen.
I received this photo, and I believe it was one of the meetings that you alleged, Mr. Oñate. Can you identify the people in the photograph?
Why can't they show the photo?
Yeah, we're trying to enlarge the picture to share it with everyone in the room. There we go. I think that's as big as we can get it. People's Initiative for Charter Change staff meeting, January 8th. Can you tell us who are in the picture, Mr. Oñate, please?
Madam Senator.
The question is who, sir?
But you said you never had any meeting.
That I coordinated with the speaker.
You said you never met the speaker. Nor Mr. Saldico, our congressman. You're under oath, sir.
Yes, that was the time that I met with the speaker.
Sasabi mo lang na hindi naman kayo nagkita. Eh, sabi niyo sina Congressman Garvin lang.
Yeah, because you know, it slipped my mind. It slipped my mind, Madam Senator. That was the
time that I sought the help of the speaker. Is Speaker Martin Romualdez supporting your group?
To help us in the signature campaign, yes.
Okay, so it's very clear that Speaker Martin Romualdez is supporting your group. He is all out behind the People's Initiative. Is that correct?
Yes, we coordinate with the Speaker and the
Congressman in getting
the 3% per congressional district. That's correct, Madam Senator.
Thank you very much for... helping us along with this investigation. I'd like to turn it back to Senator Cheese.
I'll wind up, Madam Chair. That was the point I wanted to establish, Madam Chair, distinguished colleagues, na maliban dun sa mga kongresistang binanggit nyo, baka na, kung si Speaker Romualdez nakalimutan yung banggitin, siguro mas marami pa kayong ibang nakalimutang banggitin. So, sa pagkakaalala nyo, kesa magpakita pa ho kami ng ibang litrato, sino pa pong mga kongresista ang nakausap nyo para makakuha ng pirma sa kada distrito?
As I have said earlier...
With the permission, Madam Chair, of... With the permission of Congressman Garvin, the question is being addressed to Mr. Oñate. Since he is the lead convener here and merely asked for the help of Congressman...
He's not the lead convener, Madam Chair, for the record.
I'm confused.
For pirma, but there's a different movement.
So pirma is no longer the lead convener.
No. Pirma is just one of the movement that goes around... Diba
magkasundo kayo? Kasi iba-iba yung sinasabi ninyo, nalilito po kami eh.
Just to be clear, Madam Chair, PIRMA is just one of the movement that goes around the country to gather signatures for this people's initiative. In the Bicol region, I may say that I'm the one leading and collecting signatures,
okay,
making it for the Bicolanos understand what they've signed for.
Salamat po. Ibalik natin kay Mr. Oñate po.
Yes, if I may go back to Mr. Oñate, because Congressman Garbin, kasama ka lang sa et al. Ang nakasulat sa petitioner, si Attorney Abad, na inamin ni Mr. Oñate na isa daw sa mga conveners nila ng PIRMA. Di po ba? So, is Attorney Abad part of Ako Bicol or the new organization you put up, or is he part of PIRMA?
Not part of Ako Bicol, not part of PIRMA, but when he started independently as an advocate of this people's initiative.
Kaangkin lang po ni Mr. Oñate na bahagi si Attorney Abad ng PIRMA.
Yes.
Sinabi niyo po kanina. Hanggang ngayon po, sinasabi niyo.
He is part of PIRMA. So, the only thing is, I think the lawyers forgot, is because the first batch of the forms that were printed, the name of Attorney Abad was used. But the subsequent forms are now PIRMA.
Okay.
Because the first batch was Anthony Abad.
Okay, ngayon, matanong ko po kayo. So kayo yung nagpa-print ng form na Attorney Abad? Yes or no?
I didn't have a hand in the printing of the forms.
No?
No.
So no. Okay.
Kayo po ba yung nagpa-print ng form na may PIRMA na nakalagay? Wala ng Attorney Abad?
Yes.
Kayo po nagpa-print?
Yeah, the subsequent forms, yes, that were printed, PIRMA na.
PIRMA na po.
Oo.
Ilan po yung...
lang yung mga naunang form, Anthony Abad.
Sino po yung nagpa-print nun? Convener niyo po si Attorney Abad?
Mga volunteers ang nagpa-print.
Yung PIRMA mismo na nakalagay, kayo na nagpa-print?
Oo, yung law firm, sila...
Magkano po ginastos nyo sa pagpapaprint ng form na may PIRMA?
I don't have the exact figures right now. Let me consult with
Please ask him. Yeah, I'm sure they should know. You knew this was going to be discussed.
Well, what I know is that the figure that I know, I don't know the figure regarding the printing of the forms, but the figure that I know is the airing of the advertisement. That's the figure that I know.
Pupunta po tayo doon. Dumuna tayo sa, mas mahal po yun eh.
The advertisement cost 55 million. ABS-CBN, TV5, and GMA7.
Yes, if Senator Cheese will allow,
I don't have the figures.
So although you printed the forms with the PIRMA at the bottom, you have no clue how much it cost.
No.
This is remarkable because
it's the staff that knows. Because I don't know everything.
With the permission of Senator Cheese, there's a quick manifestation from Senator Bato here.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Oñate, I just would like to remind you na sana ba remind lang kita, baka sunod-sunod yung pagsisinungaling mo ba? Ha? Una, alam mo, under oath ka. Tapos sinabi mo kanina, you never had a meeting with the speaker, kung sino-sino mang nasa likuran nito. Ngayon, when we show you the picture, sabi mo, it slips your mind. Kaya I'm just giving you a fair warning, ha? Fair warning. Please, do not lie before this committee. Please, do not lie before this committee, ha? Magpakatotoo tayo dito.
Ha? No, because I was asking my lawyers sino yung pwede kong banggitin, and sinabi nila si Rufus Rodriguez and Congressman Harbin.
Kaya nga, but sabi mo kanina,
say,
tinanong ka ng chairman.
I didn't know Speaker Mualdez, and I didn't say that.
Hindi kasama sa meeting, pero nandiyan, may picture.
In fact, if you check my interviews with the various radio stations, I mentioned to them that I went to Speaker Romualdez to seek his assistance regarding People's Initiative.
Madam Chair.
Thank you for that clarification.
I admitted in various interviews.
Madam Chair, I saw your interviews actually, Mr. Oñate, and you were very vocal and honest about the fact that you sought the Speaker's assistance. Now, may I ask, what kind of assistance did he give you?
Administrative and advisory.
Because
being the Speaker, he is like the CEO.
Of the House?
Of Congress, yes.
So ano po yung administrative na tulong na binigay niya sa'yo para makalap yung 3% per district?
Yung mga tao namin, pupunta sa isang distrito, makikipag-coordinate sila sa congressman because it's the congressman who is in turn the CEO of the district. Kasi distrito niya yun eh. So natural lamang
kaya sinasabi ninyo,
na pupuntahan
sa maling
namin yung
sabi.
Congressman.
So, hindi talaga kaya ng pirma isa-isahin ang mga distrito. Ang nakatutok, si Speaker, inuutusan yung mga congressman. Tama?
Hindi naman po. Kami po ang pumupunta sa mga
pagsasabihan
congressman
ko lang si Atty. Abisado na huwag mag-coach, please. Anong sabi po ninyo? Hindi ninyo kaya, di ba, sa pirma? Kasi napakaraming distrito. So, nagpatulong kayo at sila yung nakatutok.
There are 250 districts, 257
districts. Inaamin ninyo na ang nakatutok, yung kongresista at si Speaker, tama po ba?
Tinutulungan kami ng kongresista dahil distrito po niya yung
Apo. Madam Chair.
Anong uri ng tulong?
Congressional district. Madam Chair, can I be recognized, Madam Chair?
No, let us finish, please. Yes, it's our hearing. Thank you. Back to Mr. Oñate po. Anong tulong ang binibigay ng mga kongresista at ni Speaker?
Ang tulong nila, kung ano yung population ng distrito nila, kung saan po... Saan kukuha ng mga boto, tinuturo nila, yun. Basically, administrative ang tulong nila.
If I may, hindi nyo naman kilala yung mahigit 250 kongresista, so kailangan talaga na makapagbigay ng administrative na tulong ang Speaker na masabihan yung mga congressman na pag nagpunta yung tao nyo doon o kayo, asikasuhin.
Opo. Inamin ko naman po sa mga radio stations at sa mga interview sa TV and all that. In fact, there are days that I'm being interviewed 3 times, 4 times a day. And grabe kung makatawag ang media.
I've seen most of the interview, sir. I've seen most of the interview.
10 beses, no? Walang tigil. Kaya, pag-coordinate ko kay Speaker, natulungan naman kami sa aming pagpapapirma sa mga distrito.
Kasama po ba sa administrative?
Kasi sumusunod lang po kami sa batas, sinasabi po ng batas, na pumunta kami sa congressional district at kumuha ng 3% per congressional district.
Kasama po ba sa tulong yung pagsang-ayon doon sa timetable na nakita at pinalabas na rin sa media na may timetable na sa gantong petsa dapat na-submit na, sa gantong petsa dapat na-file nyo na, sa gantong petsa dapat i-verify, sa gantong petsa dapat plebisito na. Ang sinasabi na ilang mambabatas ay June, July daw dapat ang target. Tama po ba yan? Kasama yun sa napag-usapan at napagkasunduan.
Pero hindi naman absolute yung target na yun. Ako nga po, sinasabi ko, kung hindi kaya ng June, July, baka September, October.
Ang tanong
kasi
ko
hindi
po...
Hindi ko rin alam eksakto kung kailan matatapos. Pero, a few months. Kaya sinabi ko din na... Kasi yan din ang tanong ng mga nag-i-interview. Sabi ko, mga 2 to 3 months because I don't have the exact timetable also.
So yung pag-set po ng timetable na yon kasama o factored in na yung administrative na assistance ni Speaker at ng ilang mga mambabatas para maitalaga yung dates na ma-meet hanggat kaya?
Yeah, more or less, we have a timetable but the timetable is not on exact dates.
And this timetable was agreed upon.
2 to 3 months, 2 to 3 weeks.
And this timetable was agreed upon or at least discussed in that meeting. This timetable was agreed upon or at least discussed in this meeting when you asked for his assistance.
Wala namang timetable na eksakto, parang...
Period, may range.
Estimate.
Opo, yung estimate na timetable na pag-usapan at napag-agrihan sa pulong na ito, o isa na ito sa mga pulong na napag-usapan yon.
Yes, more or less po.
Ngayon, maliban sa administrative na tulong, ano pa po ang binigay na tulong ng tanggapan ng speaker?
Wala na po.
Dalawa po yung binanggit nyo kanina. May I appeal to the record?
An advisory.
Ano pong advisory ang binigay sa inyo?
Ina-advise kami kung saan maraming mga tao na pipirma, kung saan. Basically, ang tinuturo nila yung C and D sector ng mga voters.
Bakit daw po?
They tell us to concentrate on the C and D kasi sila ang nakakarami. We were told that 75 to 80% of our voters belong to the C&D market. So doon kami nagpupunta.
Sino po nagsabi sa inyo?
Yung mga congressmen po. Maliban... Alam nila kung saan madaming mga butante.
Kung saan madami para mas madaling puntahan.
Yeah, parang kunyari, let's say you're going to a supermarket and then you want to buy something. Mm. Of course, you cannot ask the supervisor of the supermarket where I can buy this stuff. Or ganun din po ang ginawa namin. Pagpunta sa distrito, tinatanong namin sa distrito, sa congressman, CEO ng distrito, kung saan kami pupunta at makakuha ng madaming pirma.
Last 2 points, Madam Chair, if you will bear with me. So, yung tagumpay ninyo thus far, na nakakuha na kayo ng mahigit 3% sa mahigit 200 distrito, hindi nyo po magagawa ito ng kayo lamang kung wala ang tulong o administrative support, advice ng mga kongresista.
Malaking tulong po ang nagbibigay ng mga kongresista sa pag-identify kung saan kami kukuha ng mga signatures.
At kung wala nga po yon, mahihirapan tulad ng mga nakaraang karanasan ninyo?
Magagawa naman po, pero medyo matatagalan.
Hindi kasing bilis tulad ngayon. Sabi nyo magagawa naman, pero kung wala ang tulong ng kongresista, hindi kasing bilis tulad ngayon.
Oo, mas mabilis kung may tulong ng kongresista kung na pinpointing to us where to get the signatures.
Ngayon, isang tanong na lamang po, yung 55 million na ginastos nyo para sa EDSA Puera ad, saan po galing yun?
Ako po ang nag-provide noon, binigay ko yung cash kay Mr. Greg Garcia. Mm. Yung aming PR, siya yung aming
si Greg
PR.
Pa gumawa nun?
Oo.
Saan po galing yung 55 million?
Pera ko po yun. Contribution sa akin ng mga kaibigan, mga supporters namin.
So mga $1 million po yun, di ba?
More or less po, opo.
So personal, magkano po sa 55 million ang pera ninyong personal?
Mga kalahati po nun.
So mga 26?
More or less. 55, mga 27
point, sorry, 27. Policy lang po ako, hindi ako math major tulad ni Senator Pimentel. Yung kalahati, saan galing yung bulto? Ano yung pinakamalaking contribution?
Yung bulto nga po, ako po ang nagpondo nun.
Yung kalahati na nga po?
Yung kalahati, maraming mga contributors.
Mga tigma magkano po?
May mga nagbigay ng 1 million, may nagbigay ng 500,000, may nagbigay ng 2 million.
Pwede niyo po bang banggitin kung sino yung mga nagbigay ng million?
I don't recall right now.
Pero pwede ninyong handa naman yung committee tanggapin pag nabigay ninyo yung record.
Can my lawyer be the one to answer that?
Who is your lawyer, by the way? Is Attorney Abisado who seems to be coaching you here as your counsel or as a resource person?
Madam Chair, I really apologize. Please, because Mr. Noel Oñate has difficulty of hearing. That's why I keep on repeating what the good Senator Escudero has been asking.
Thank you, sir.
I just really, Your Honor, I do not coach. I'm really sorry.
So may we know that the million peso contributors? Yung 1 million and above lang.
I have to ask them if I can give their names.
Sige, dahil ang problema dyan, di ba may donor's tax din dyan, Senator Cheese?
Yan yung math major, oh.
Oh, di. Nagbayad ba sila ng donor's tax?
I can compute the amount because that's math, pero ang tanong legal eh.
Yeah,
there should be my opinion, Madam Chair. There should be.
Kindly inquire, sir, if they consent.
6%.
And we will also research if we can compel. The reason why perhaps the committee can compel disclosure is because, you know, public interest demands accountability and transparency. Hindi ito isang bagay na kinakahiya. Tulad nga ng sinabi ni Congressman Garbin kanina, noon pa niya paborito, noon pa niya gusto to. Chairman pa lang siya ng Consti Amendments. And in fact, it's the first time that I thought Congressman Garbin was one of your lawyers, but apparently he's one of the conveners. But it's the first time that I saw him. So, this matter of PI, if you really believe in it, it's not something that you should be ashamed or embarrassed about. The same is true with your donors. And on the part of the public, on our part, well, accountability and transparency dictate that we should know who are the people behind it. Let me give you some advice, Mr. Oñate, if you really believe in charter change. For me, I may be wrong. The main reason why PIRMA has failed in its past attempts, and probably even this one, is because people don't trust those who are supposedly behind it because they're always hiding behind someone else. So it's an opportunity for your donors as well to come out and be proud of that. I will not fault them for believing in something that I disagree with, for example. In fact, I will respect them for coming out in the open. Kumbaga, kung ayaw nilang lumabas, wala silang pinagkaiba dun sa mga nakatestigo kanina nakamasker at nakashades. Hindi naman po siguro ganun yun. Wala naman silang inaakusan na krimen na ginawa. This is something I believe that they should stand up and be counted for. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Mr. Oñate. I hope you will talk to your donors.
The bulk of the money came from me. So,
we take note of that, sir.
The bulk of the money came from me.
Thank you. Madam Chair, for the record on the responses of the resource persons to send cheese, brief manifestation.
Yes, Senator Cheese is done.
Thank you, Senator Madam Larissa. Chair, I think narinig po nating lahat yung mga sagot ng ating mga resource persons mula sa PIRMA, Attorney Garbin K. Sanchez, punong-puno ng pagkalito at saka disagreement. And I will ask questions on that later, but I wish to note that this confusion, this disagreement, is brought about precisely because there's no sufficient enabling law for people's initiative. Only Congress can provide the rules. And as of today, we have not yet, Madam Chair, for the record.
Again, Madam Chair, can I answer? Being one of the petitioner of this.
I'm sorry, I think we have many resource persons led by Justice Carpio, Justice Ascuna, and the rest who will respond to that query later on. May I proceed with Mr.
Madam,
Oñate?
Madam Chair.
Yes, Senator.
At any rate, pwede naman mag-position paper or memorandum
yes,
sila, Attorney Garbin.
We will
Garbin
welcome your position
issue,
paper, Attorney Garbin.
Madam Chair, just
but
to,
just on just the point to, of there's no enabling
you,
law.
Don't, he's not recognized.
This is a matter of debate, and we simply have no time at this hearing.
There's a developing consensus over here, Madam Chair, that we can compel our resource person, Mr. Oñate, to divulge the names of his donors. At 12:30 p.m. pa lang naman, hindi pa naman tayo patapos, he can call his office to get the names. The names must be divulged to this committee this afternoon before we end. Dapat ganun. Oh, kasi tama, narinig namin yung kay Senator Cheese, and I hope Mr. Oñate agrees with Senator Cheese. Public, ganun to eh, public issues, wag mahiya yung nag-donate. Oh.
Yeah, Mr. Senator, I already disclosed or I already admitted that the bulk of the money came from me.
So you have a partial compliance. We need full compliance. So
yeah, yung mga ibang amount naman maliliit na.
Di bali po, kami na po ako na po magsusuma total doon sa ama. Sige po. Yung 27.5 million ang ating account po. Sige po. So what do we do with that matter, Madam Chair? I think we should compel the
we therefore compel Mr. Oñato to produce the said documents at the soonest possible time. Yes, Attorney Avisado, please.
You have to give me time to talk to them kasi ako naman lang mapapahiya sa mga kung banggitin ko yung mga pangalan nila, you know,
Kasasabi lang po ng minority leader before 2 p.m. sana this afternoon, magsesesyon pa kami eh. At saka madali naman yun eh.
Madam Chairman,
naka-record naman yan.
May I be allowed to ask a few questions to Mr. Oñate?
I'm sorry, Congressman. I think our rules don't allow resource persons to interpellate po. Okay lang. Okay. But everyone agrees to suspend in your case.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Mr. Oñate, alam po ninyo yung kahalagahan ng initiative na ito at kakailanganin ninyo ang maraming resources dito. Hindi po biro-biro ito, tama po?
Yes, I agree.
Yung pagpapapirma lamang po, Mr. Oñate, kakailanganin ninyo ang hindi kukulangin ng 8 milyon para ma-address nyo yung threshold na 12% ng ating total registered voters, hindi po ba?
12% of our total number of voters is about 8 million.
Oo nga po. Ngayon, meron po tayong about 257 legislative districts. Alam po ninyo yun. Kailangan po ninyong masatisfy yung second threshold na 3%. Kaya napilitan kayo, ayaw nyo man siguro, na magpatulong na kayo sa mga representatives ng kanikanyang distrito. Tama po ba yun?
Yes, that's correct.
Sapagkat nagiging practical kayo siguro, sapagkat sa inyo lang, siguro kahit na yung et al na ito, ilan po ba kayo? Kahit na siguro 100 kayo, mahihirapan pa rin kayo na pumunta sa iba't ibang dako ng ating kapulungan para magpapirma lang kayo, lalo na kung ipaliliwanag pa ninyo, sapagkat hindi pipirma ang tao kapag hindi nila ganap na naunawaan kung ano ang kanilang pinipirmahan. Yung bahagi ng pagpunta sa kanila, pagpapaliwanag, yun po yung malaking panahon na kakailanganin ninyo. Kaya naisipan ninyong pumunta siguro sa mga miyembro ng House of Representatives. Tama po, Mr. Oñate?
Tama po.
Pero nakalimutan mo akong puntahan, di ba?
Yeah, okay. Kasi hindi ko.
Oh, ngayon, dahil wala akong
hindi
district.
Hindi ko po kayo kasi.
Ngayon, ganito po. Mr. Oñate, meron po ba kayong nalalaman na batas na pinagbabawal po yung ginawa ninyo na makipag-ugnayan sa mga kongresista?
Wala naman po kasi People's Initiative is enshrined in our Constitution and it is the right of the people to make that initiative. Yun po ang sabi sa akin ng mga lawyer.
So wala pong batas na nagbabawal sa inyo, lalong-lalo na po kung kayo'y nagpapatulong dahil sa paniwala ninyo, ito ay isang bagay na kinakailangan ninyong gawin. So lumapit po kayo, dapaniwala ninyo na wala namang batas na nagbabawal nito at hindi po kayo makukulong. Tama po?
Tama po.
Salamat po, Madam Chair.
Thank you for all the leading questions. Madam. Maraming salamat sa ating kongresista. Napakagaling na abogado para kay Mr. Oñate.
Madam Chair.
Gusto ko lang balikan yung ating retrato na nandito sa harap natin. Galing po ito sa cellphone ninyo, January 8. Tama po ba, Mr. Oñate?
Oo, tama.
And that's in fact you in the picture, that's correct?
You confirm that it's you.
You confirm that this is you in the picture?
Yes.
And you also confirm that it's Speaker Romualdez in the picture?
Yes.
And it is Congressman Saldico in the picture?
Yes, yeah.
Can you read the caption, please? Yung caption sa ilalim po. Meron kasi yeah,
yes,
diba?
That's true. That's correct. Tama po.
At maliban sa pagkain, klaro na may mga dokumento sa table. Meeting po to, hindi lang party. Anong pinag-usapan?
Meeting po 'yan kung paano kami makikipag-coordinate sa mga congressmen.
Saan lugar to? Saan ginanap itong parting to? Para lang malaman namin.
Sa ano po yun? Sa townhouse sa Forbes, sa Forbes Park.
Kanino nga? Kaninong lugar? Ipaliwanag. Wala namang masama magtipon-tipon sa bahay ng Miss Kishino.
Dalawang townhouse.
Hindi, kanino po? Kaninong lugar? Inyo? Bahay mo? Bahay mo po?
It's a meeting
Attorney
place.
Avisado,
it's our,
please.
It's our meeting place.
No, pero sino may-ari?
Sino
may-ari ng bahay?
Si Speaker Romualdez po.
Bahay ni Speaker Romualdez.
Yes.
Ah, ganon. So, ang naging host po, at nagkumbida ay si Speaker Romualdez. Tama po ba?
Ako po ang nagkumbida. Dapat
paano ko magkukumbida? Hindi mo bahay.
Oo nga. Oo nga po. Dapat po yan sa bahay ko. Dahil meron ho akong party house sa Dasma, walang tao doon.
Pero hindi ba maliwanag na kung bahay ni Speaker...
Ang sabi ng staff, doon na lang gawin sa bahay ni Speaker. Dalawang bahay ni Speaker eh. Isa sa McKinley at isa...
Hindi ba maliwanag kung bahay ni Speaker siya nagpatawag ng meeting, edi talagang nakikialam si Speaker sa People's Initiative?
Ako po ang nag-initiate ng meeting, pero sinabi po na doon na lang gawin sa townhouse ni Speaker. But ako po ang nag-initiate.
Ay,
dapat
ganon.
Po sa bahay ko, pero sinabihan ako na doon na lang pumunta.
Sino nagdala ng papeles? Kasi bahay niya. Ikaw nagdala ng papel.
Yung mga lawyer po.
Yung mga lawyer
po dala nila.
So, bahagi ka talaga ng Project PI. Yung Project PI na tinetext sa mga kongresista, pati ako nga na-text kasi luma na yung number ko eh. Bahagi kayo ng Project PI?
Yeah. Kasi I thought the help of the speaker, inamin ko naman po,
you've said that
natulungan
before.
Kami okay. Dito sa signature gathering.
Right. Okay, kilala ninyo itong sina Attorney Redentor Tuason?
I don't know.
Suset Sumalinog, Timothy Lagundi. Kilala ninyo itong mga to?
Hindi po.
Okay. Kasi meron kaming mga screenshot doon sa Project PI na galing sa mga congressman. At sabi mo, nakikipag-coordinate ka kay Speaker na CEO at sa mga hawak
ng Congress. Congressman. Yeah, that's correct, Madam Senator.
Okay. So,
Madam Chair?
Yes, Senator Bato, please. Ayan yung mga screenshot. Kasi sabi mo, bahagi ka ng Project PI. Nagtatanong lang ako, baka kilala mo itong mga to. Andito, yung mga pangalan.
Hindi pala ninyo kilala.
Hindi ko kilala. Anong pagkaintindi mo dyan sa message na yan? Pakibasa lang po.
Hindi ko po alam, I don't know all of the details because you know
De lahat ng kongresista pinapasubmit ano sa National Secretariat Attorney Red Tuason. Ayun. Ayan ang hinihingi nila, yung mga kopya at saka accomplished signature forms. Kasi sabi ninyo, may kinalaman kayo sa second batch ng signature forms, di po ba?
Yes.
So, isasubmit dito sa mga taong hindi ninyo kilala, samantalang kayo ang nagpa-imprenta? Senator Bato, please.
Madam Chair, gusto ko lang ipakonfirm kay Mr. Oñate. Since sinabi niya kanina na he sought the help of the speaker para makakuha ng perma, so pumayag siya. In fact, nag-meeting kayo, di ba?
Yes.
Pumayag siya. So meaning, sinabi mo, pirma ang nasa likuran nitong People's Initiative. Humingi kayo ng suporta galing kay Speaker Romualdez. Binigyan kayo ng tulong, ng suporta para mag para tumakbo ng inyong People's Initiative. Ibig sabihin, si Speaker Romualdez isa na rin sa nasa likod ng
pumayag naman po si Speaker.
Pumayag
si Speaker.
Nasa likuran na rin siya.
Natulungan kami kasi siya ang CEO ng Congress.
Kaya nga gusto ko lang i-confirm sa iyo na siya rin ay kasama na nasa likod na rin ng pagpatakbo ng PI dahil nga tumulong siya sa inyo, di ba?
Yeah, he is helping us.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that answer.
Madam Chair.
Maraming salamat. So kinukumpirma mo. Para naguguluhan ako. Kinukumpirma na politicians initiative tulad ng sinabi ni Senator.
Hindi naman po. Tumutulong lang sila. Pero kami ang nasa forefront ng pagpapapirma. Oo. Wala okay. Naman, palagay ko, wala namang masama na tumanggap ng tulong
okay.
Sa mga congressmen.
Senator JB Sige, oh tama naman. Patulong kayo sa lahat ng tao, lalong-lalo na yung mga CEO ng malalaking kapulungan. Senator JV, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Curious ako, pwede tanungin si Mr. Oñate or the conveners of itong BI. Of all the provisions that can be amended under the Constitution, bakit napili ng pirma amendan yung provision on the manner of voting? Di ba? Kasi pagkakaalam ko, na kung meron kayong gustong amendahan sa konstitusyon, dapat ang tatanungin either political or economic provisions, pero yung voting provisions or manner of voting nakalagay doon, voting jointly. Bakit po yun? Gusto ko lang pong maliwanagan.
As one of the petitioner, Mr. Chair, Senator Ejercito, we specifically propose amendment to the manner of voting because this is the consistent roadblock that prevents the Republic of the Philippines, the Senate and the House to propose amendment to the Constitution. When I was the chair of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments, we passed the RBH2. Pinasa namin sa House of Representatives, 19th Congress. We transmitted the RBH2 to the Senate.
Di ba kung People's Initiative, pwede naman diretso sa economic provisions?
Para tama po, and that's why, let me...
Principle, economic na kagad.
Yes po.
Bakit hindi economic ang
you cannot put one subject in a petition. That's Republic Act 6735, of which you cannot put more than one subject in a petition. And that's why two... erase that roadblock, which is a consistent roadblock in proposing this amendment to the Constitution, might as well that infirmity or ambiguity in the interpretation on how Congress will vote, sitting as Constituent Assembly, dapat ho maklarify. And that's why ito po yung pinakarason. Kasi kung ilalagay po natin yung Article 12, 14, and 16 of the 1987 Constitution, which speaks of the restrictive economic provisions of the Constitution that would be inviolative of Republic Act 6735, that prescribe that there should be no more than one subject in a petition.
Madam Chair.
Alam rin namin yon ang ating SP.
Yes, Madam Chair. Let us go back to the subject matter at hand.
Boss SP, because, may I just put on record because being the chair of the Committee on Rules, only RBH 6 of the House calling for a constitutional convention was actually transmitted by Congress to the Senate. The RBH 2 has not been transmitted. That's for the record.
Madam Chair, you might forget, the majority leader might forget that in the 18th Congress, June of 2021, and you were still a member of that Congress.
Are we going to talk about the other Congresses or even the history of Congress? In fact, Madam Chair, I was about to make mention about the statements made by Mr. Oñate. If this is indeed a people's initiative and not a political initiative, bakit nanggagaling lahat sa politiko? Bakit sila yung nagtatarget sino yung mag-i-initiate? Hindi ho ba klaro na ito ay politician's initiative? Just to point it out, Madam Chair.
Baka naman siguro, Madam Chair, as you recognize me already, baka hadlang ang Senado sa mga agenda ng ibang politiko. Diba? Ganun lang naman yun eh. With due respect, Madam Chair, the point of order I see is that let's go back to the germane. What's germane to this topic, which is the signature buying, manipulation being done.
Thank you
is
very
it being
much.
Through people's initiative or politicians' initiative. Let's go back to that. We will have our hearings on this issue on charter change where we can invite our distinguished friends, former congressmen and congressmen to those hearings together with the justices, together with ex-justices, deans, and constitutionalists to debate on that issue. But at this point in time, let's go back to the main point of this hearing, which is we're trying to look for shenanigans in the part of getting and collecting these signatures.
Maraming salamat. Yes, and thank you very much for SP for establishing order. And indeed, it's a massive feat to conduct a Project PI requiring massive funds. And you said that you largely, Mr. Oñate, funded PIRMA, at least with the EDSA Puera commercial. And you also admitted that it was upwards of $55 million that you spent. Do you have the receipt?
I think so. I think we have a receipt.
Is it your office or your corporation or PIRMA's an NGO that paid for the ad?
Yeah, because I gave the money in cash to Mr. Greg Garcia, and he was the one that paid the advertising agency.
I'm a little bit confused. I was informed, but that in fact payment was made to Ghana Atienza Avisado Law Office. Why was it necessary to go through the law office? Did you need an escrow or trust account?
I gave the cash to...
If I may, Madam Chair.
Can we allow Mr. Oñate to finish his sentence?
I gave the cash to Greg Garcia, who is our PR, and I think Mr. Greg Garcia was the one that paid the ad agency. I don't know whether it was coursed to somebody else, but
So in fact, it was cash. There was no receipt. There was no BIR, no donor's tax, no documentation. It was cold, hard cash. Is that correct?
Yeah, it is. It was. I gave it to him in cold cash because, well, that's how politics works.
I'm sorry, that's how politics operates, through cash?
I've also been a political consultant all these years, and I know how it works.
55 kilos of cash, sir. Hindi, ang sabi kasi binayaran through the law office. Naguguluhan ako because you said you handed over $55 million in cash to Mr. Greg Garcia, isang bulto. Paano pumasok yung ating mga abogado?
Madam Chair, if I may.
Yes, Attorney Avisado.
To explain our role in the TV ad, what happened was this was very early start of the year. And... when Mr. Noel Oñate engaged the firm of Mr. Greg Garcia for the creative agency, Mr.
Teka,
Garcia...
Teka, naguguluhan ako. At in the beginning of this year?
Yes po.
Eh, nag-umpisa to, December pa eh.
Yes po. On the creative aspect po, last year pa. And then, payment should be made for the TV stations ASAP. But since PIRMA could not comply, wala ho kasi, marami ho kasing documentary requirements. So what we did, kami na as the law office, since we can comply with all the documentary requirements ng pag-post nitong TV ads, kami na po ang nag-submit.
But yung payment ho,
when we were sent the bill, we gave it to Mr. Oñate and sabi namin, sir, ito na ho yung billing ng ad agency, kayo na ho bahala magbayad. That's what happened po.
Asan ang resibo? Kanino ginawa yung resibo? Kay Mr. Oñate, sa PIRMA, o sa Abisado Law Office?
Ma'am, wala pa pong OR pero meron ho yatang invoice. Tama? Oh, may invoice ho kami to the law office kasi kami yung lumalabas na advertiser having complied with all the documentary requirements.
So ibibigay ninyo sa amin yung OR, walang resibo at sekreto sa BIR kasi wala rin donor stocks.
Yes. Ma'am, wala pa po kaming OR but we have a billing invoice that we can submit.
Sige, titignan namin. So ano nangyari dun sa cash? Akala ko ang nagkaliwaan ay yung cash ni Mr. Oñate dun kay Mr. Garcia. Paano pumasok yung law office? Di ko pa rin maintindihan eh.
Kami lang po nag-represent kay Mr. Oñate.
Bakit kailangan ng representation? May dala-dalang bultong ka.
That's a separate matter po.
Ha? Marami pa kaysa sa 55 million?
Hindi ma'am, when we told Madam Chair, Mr. Oñate, sir, ito ho yung bill. Kayo na hong bahala magbayad. Then he said, sige, ako nang bahala. And then yung invoice ho, sa amin ho pinadala. And we will comply. We will submit the invoice sent to our office, pero wala pa pong official receipt. And the amount that Mr. Oñate paid, kasama na po lahat yon, both the creative aspect of the ad and the TV placements for the three TV stations, TV5, ABS-CBN, and GMA7. Yun po. Thank you.
Pero ikaw ang nagsabi, baka pwede mong sabihin kung sino yung ibang donor. Pagkat ikaw yung nagpa-interview at sinabi nyo, ambag-ambag, tulong-tulong, Attorney Abisado, di ba sinabi mo yon? Na puro donations sa iba't ibang volunteer.
Yes, ma'am, I remember I told that. Yun din ho yung representation sa amin ni Mr. Oñate. And that is consistent with what he said earlier, that he paid the bulk of the TV ads, sarili niya pong pera. And the others, meron din ho yatang ambag-ambag.
Abogado ba kayo ng pirma o member, lead convener din?
Ma'am, hindi po. We are lawyers of Mr. Oñate. He has been our client many years before. And in fact, he is related by affinity to our managing partner, Attorney Aris Gana. Magkamag-anak po sila. So that explains the connection between our firm and Mr. Oñate.
What explains the connection of your firm to Speaker Romualdez? Andito po, ang liwaliwanag ng Congress dito sa posting na ikaw ay isang consultant ng Office of the Speaker. Itong retratong to nasa labas ng Speaker's office.
Ma'am, Madam Chair, hindi po ako consultant. You can check all the records. I'm not a consultant. But I don't deny, I know the Speaker. He is a fraternity brother of the fraternity brother in the Upsilon. And kami po, we go a long way. But ang client po namin dito, hindi po si Speaker, kundi si Mr. Noel Oñate. That picture, hindi ho ako, that was one of those times na sumama ho kami, tumingin, pumunta lang ho dun sa Congress, kasama ho kasi yung isang associate ho namin na nandito. Pero ma'am,
pero, so mali si Congressman JJ, kasi anong liwanag, consultant to the Office of the Speaker.
Yes po, with all due respect to the good Congressman, hindi po consultant ni Speaker, and the record should bear me out.
Di ba naging abogado ka rin ng tingog?
Ni-refer po ako ni Speaker kay sa mga kamag-anak, kay Mayor Alfred Romualdez, who's been my client. And if you will admit, I am very proud being one of your lawyers, Madam Chair.
Kaya nga alam ko na ang pagkaalam ko, consultant ka eh. Kaya nagtataka.
Hindi po. How I wish I was a consultant. Dagdag rin po yon, pero hindi po ako consultant.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Like to,
on the topic lang.
Yes po.
Bakit po nahirapan ang pirma for the documentary requirements? In 1990, organization pa po ang pirma eh. So, what's wrong with their documents?
Very good question, Senator Pimentel. Hindi ho kasi updated yung payments. In fact, to be honest, updated yung records nila. In fact, ngayon ho kami palang nag-a-update ng records kasi ho, yung mga stalwarts ng pirma, sino Mr. Pedrosa and the other kasama ni Mr. Oñate, wala na po ngayon. So, nag-aayos pa ho kami. And since kailangan ho namin mag-comply, kami na lang ho nag-step in.
So kung ang TV stations ay pinagdududahan o hindi qualified ang papers ng pirma, baka pagdating na nito sa COMELEC, even yung exist judicial, juridical existence ng pirma, eh, in doubt na rin po kasi even TV stations will not air an ad because of the questionable papers of pirma. So how much more amend the constitution through pirma? I mean, that's just just an opinion na kung ganyan na sa TV ads lang ha, hindi na pasado papelis ng pirma, and then you will say we are the group behind this then we will file the petition sa COMELEC.
That is well noted, Mr. Good Senator. In fact, we agree with your sentiments. We respect your sentiments. Kami po sa pirma, for the record, we are against any form of vote buying, bribery, or aid in exchange for signatures because alam ho namin, napakahigpit ho ng COMELEC. They will invalidate all the signatures given a very slight evidence of bribery. So, sayang naman ho ang pinaghinapan ng mga volunteers ho at yung coordinators ng pirma. So, maingat din ho kami, sir.
When did you start soliciting signatures?
This year po, ang umpisa ho namin, Senator, is the information campaign which was started by that TV ad.
The signatures. Ito mga form na with signatures. December pa to umiikot na eh.
Yes po. When we discussed, kami sa pirma this year po, pero yung grupo ni na Attorney Garbin, wala ho kasi kaming monopoly on people's initiative. Marami din ho kasing gumalaw. So maybe Attorney Garbin can also
pirma,
speak for his group.
Pirma can tell this committee January.
Public information started with the sir, with the TV ads, ad, okay. And then after that, nag-gather na ho kami. Nauna sina Attorney Garbin.
Pirma muna, pirma. Can you give me a date? When did you start soliciting signatures as pirma? Just a date.
January 2,
2024. Si Attorney Garbin would be the attorney about the signature sheets. Yeah. Mga December pa po yan, tama?
No, on our part,
first batch.
Ako, concerned lang po ako sa Bicol region. Nag-start po kami January 5, including the distribution of the forms, the signature sheets.
So yung mga Mindanao, hindi nyo na, wala na kayo yun?
Wala na po. Bicol region lang po ako.
Pero
Senator Coco, natanggap ko yung timeline at yung form, December 23.
Yes, December to sa Mindanao. Ayan ang feedback na sa akin. Pero, so who will be the knowledgeable person to us, sa grupo po ninyo, about the national movement?
Yung movement po namin ay maraming convener.
Okay.
But for every region, may assigned. Ako po yung assigned sa Region 5. Okay. Sa Region 5. And I called four governors, and the Liga ng mga barangays to facilitate.
If the committee is interested to know the movement sa Mindanao, who do we ask in your group?
Wala ho po akong alam.
Sino bang nakataas sa'yo as the regional coordinator of Bicol Region? Sino pang nakataas? Because yun ang pupunta.
Kami ho yung nag-uusap. Kami ni na Attorney Abad, kasama si Noel Oñate, Justice Biloso, former congressman, and Argel Kabatbat. Opo.
Okay. So lumalabas, Madam Chair, there may actually be two signature sheets na umiikot. Ibang wording nun. So kailangan conscious din po tayo ron. And once this is...
Just to add minority leader.
Let me finish, Attorney Garbin. Once this is formally to be presented, dadaan po sa microscope yung mga kada salita dun sa signature sheets na to kasi magkaiba pala, hindi dalawang grupo. And is it possible that there is also a third group, more than two groups?
There are numerous groups for this national movement.
Kanya-kanya sila sa signature campaign?
Tama po.
Okay, so ganun pala. So it's not, talagang i-examinin po lahat ito. Kanya-kanyang approach din sila, Madam
Chair. And just to add, Minority Leader, if I may finish.
Madam Chair, Attorney Garbin wants to be recognized.
Yes, that when we treat each signatory, we tell them that petitioner din po sila. Hindi lang po si Attorney Abad, hindi lang po ako. Lahat na nag-gather naming signature, pinapaintindi namin sa kanila that they will be, part of this and be one of the petitioners of the People's Initiative.
Okay, notarized ba yung kada signature sheet?
Hindi po, but...
So paano, bagsak na kagad sa verified petition yun?
But as as you see the signature sheet.
No, I'm just reacting, Madam Chair, to the inputs of Attorney Garbin. If all the signatories are to be treated as petitioners, bagsak na required. May we ask the COMELEC, doon po sa 10650 na sinuspend din nyo, ang petition ba to be filed on People's Initiative must be a verified petition?
Yes.
So we go back to the definition of what is a verification. All petitioners. So if the signature sheets and the signatories are treated as petitioners, but these are not under oath, I think the theory already falls flat on its face.
Madam Chair, let me respond.
No,
the signatures will be part of the petition.
Madam Chair, follow-up question to Attorney Garbin.
Yes, Senator Risa has precedence.
Gyamanak, Madam Chair. Attorney Garbin, sabi nyo, in-assign po kayo sa Bicol. Sino po nag-assign sa inyo?
Ang aking sino sarili po.
Ang sino aking po nagkukumpas
ako
kung
po.
Sino ang ma-assign
ako
sa
po.
Sa
As I have said,
region.
I've been the chairman of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments. This has been my advocacy since 18th Congress. Naipasa natin sa House of Representatives, na i-transmit natin dito sa Senado, ng 18th Congress. And my exasperation, Senator Intuberos, was that it was not acted upon by this body. And therefore, ang nakita ko, ito na yung solusyon. Ako rin, gagalaw na rin ako upang ikayatin yung ating taong bayan na sumama dito sa isang makabuluhang pagbabago sa ating
kaya
Constitution.
At kaya gumagalaw, Attorney Garbin and Madam Chair, ang Senado, dahil sa tingin namin, may mga tamang paraan at may mga maling paraan. Sa ibang mga rehiyon po, sino nag-assign, kung sino in charge sa bawat rehiyon?
Wala po akong alam kung sino nag-assign sa ibang region.
Sino
but as you mentioned about tamang pamamaraan, Senator Antiveros.
No, it's okay po.
Even put
I don't
putting,
have an answer to that. That was
Thank
not
you.
A question, Madam Chair. Yeah. So lastly po, in-assign nyo ang sarili nyo. Kinukumpas nyo sarili nyo.
Well, I have, you know, encouraged some of the governors to help me. The Liga of Municipalities of the Philippines, Albay Chapter, spearheaded the movement in Albay, and we were able to get at least 15% of the registered voters in the three districts of Albay. So, meaning, doon sa tatlong distrito, siguro minimum 15% yung aming nakuha.
At sa ibang rehiyon po, kanyang pag-assign din sa sarili.
Siguro po, yung may mga movement din doon na pinapangunahan ng ibang organisasyon, yun din po yung nangyayari ngayon sa buong bansa.
So, siguro Madam Chair, dun sa pagbubusisi ng minority leader sa bawat isinumiting pirma, ay pwede rin itanong yung ano yung naging role ng regional leader. Lalo na kung nag-self-assign sila, Madam Chair. Reminds me visions of Napoleon taking the crown from the hand of the Pope and crowning himself. So, but we can go into that later, Madam Chair, to verify.
Gyamanak, Madam Chair. Thank you very much, Senator Risa. And I'm in full agreement with the minority. I'm completely perplexed by this text, which I myself also received since I maintain my old congressional numbers. At ito yung natanggap ko na may alok na pagkaliwaliwanag 5 million DSWD, 10 million MAIP sa DOH at 5 million sa DOLE Cash for Work Tupad. At ang mga pumirma ay napakaliwanag, inanyayahan rin namin mga empleyado, yung INC-yan, mga chief of staff yata ng kongresista to, Randy Londres, Attorney Ray Trahe, Kirby Bragais, Ana Jimenez, Annie Rose Mercado. Ang sabi sa akin ng ating committee secretary, hindi daw dumalo, kaya siguro kung maaari, isampina na po natin para magkaliwanagan ba't nagkaganon. At kung bakit yung mga pera na isinamtabi at binigay na natin para sa mahihirap emergency and crisis situations, biglang ipamumudmod sa mga pumipirma. Anong klase yun? Kaya't eto nga, ito yung message na talagang kinalat ng maigi at kailangan alamin natin kung ano ang mga pangyayaring yan. So pagdating na lang siguro nila, siya sa atin natin itong mga bagay-bagay tungkol sa napakalaking alok ng 20 million sa kada isang kongresista. Okay, andito eh, ang liwanag, name of congressman, ilagay yung district at saka yung partido, nakaka-intriga. At yun siguro. Nandito po yung COMELEC, kanina pa nag-iintay, kung okay lang sa inyo, tuloy na tayo kay Chairman George Garcia at yung iba't iba pa. Nanarito, ang pagkaalam ko, si Senator Francis Tolentino, ang interesado magtanong, andito ang lahat ng COMELEC commissioners natin, puwera lang kay Commissioner Perolino. Pero lahat kumpleto. Maraming salamat.
Madam Chair.
Yes, Madam Chair. I think Senator
Madam Chair, because I thought you wanted to talk about the COMELEC.
We're already beginning with the testimony of COMELEC.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Wala po akong tatanungin sa ibang mga resource persons. Rather than, I'll focus sa COMELEC. Yesterday, an en banc resolution came out. May this committee be clarified as to the current operative legal framework that we have now.
Madam Chair, Your Honors, magandang hapon po. As far as the COMELEC is concerned, as of this time, our resolution 10650, the one that we are using for purposes of the People's Initiative, is suspended. And therefore, as far as we are concerned, our local COMELEC election officers will not accept anything from anybody submitting any document concerning any signatures. At the same time, lahat po ng aspeto ng proseso ng People's Initiative are likewise suspended as of this time.
With the sufferance of Senator Tolentino, may I simply recognize our legal luminaries. We are honored by the presence of Justice Adolfo S. Ascuna, who may interject at any point. Our good Justice Tony Carpio, the Dean of La Salle, Jose Manuel Chel Diocno. I think Attorney Romy Macalintal is also here. And I invite you to interject and participate in this discussion at any point. Thank you.
Yes, Chair. Senator Tolentino. Maybe clarify from the good chairman, what is the meaning of this interpretation of suspend? You suspend the effects, you suspend the implementation, suspend the acceptance of signatures. Ano po yung eksaktong para maintindihan ng mga kababayan natin?
Suspend all in all. Suspend the acceptance, suspend the implementation, suspend the execution, suspend anything in relation to the People's Initiative because that is the law, that is the rule that we are observing. We honestly believe, Your Honors, Madam Chair, that COMELEC Resolution 10650 in its present form and content is insufficient.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. But yesterday we also heard from Total News reports that you intend to reframe, rehash, correct the existing Resolution 10650, ano po yung gagawin? Mabaguhin o i-amend? You found loopholes? Ano po yung gagawin doon?
Maraming sa amin. Kasama na rin po, Madam Chair, Your Honors, yung enhance. Kasi po, Madam Chair, yung mga pinag-uusapan po kanina pa dito sa committee, katulad po nung mga issue ng may issue ng paggamit ng pondo, halimbawa, sa Section 16 po ng COMELEC Resolution 10650, nakalagay po doon, bawal ang paggamit ng public fund for purposes of signature campaign. Pero yung pong provision na yon ng COMELEC Resolution 10650, hanggang doon lang po. Wala pong nakalagay doon sa issue ng are we going to remove the names? What will happen to the names of these people who perhaps have received something from anybody? Wala po sa rules yun. So ibig sabihin po, pagdating kung sakali po magkakaroon ng isang formal petition sa Commission on Elections na hanggang ngayon po ay wala pa, magkakaproblema po kami, Madam Chair, Your Honors, yung mga local COMELEC namin will insist just by looking na lang po sa signatures and determining whether they are voters. They may not even accept any objection to each and every signature because it's lacking in our rules. Isa pa lang po yun sa mga instances, Madam Chair, Your Honors, nang magiging problema later on kung sakaling we will allow this entire process to proceed.
And may we know from the good chairman, how long will this curative process last? Ganong katagal yung gagawin to?
We're hoping, Madam Chair, Your Honors, that nobody or not even a single group will be pressuring the COMELEC to immediately come up with a guideline. Alam niyo po, Madam Chair, yung pong kaso ng Lambino versus Comelec, 2006 po yon. The ponensya, ponente of which was Justice Carpio. Eh, it took the Comelec 14 years to draft Comelec Resolution 10650. So kung 14 years nga po yun na draft eh, so sana po wag kaming ipilit na mag-draft ka agad ng guidelines.
Kaya ko po tinatanong to, Mr. Chairman, is that we're not discussing here the, we're not questioning the constitutional authority of the Commission on Elections to craft its own rules. But kung babalikan natin Santiago case, operative word there is inadequate. Republic Act 6735 is inadequate. Kung babalikan po natin yung Lambino case, Lambino never overruled or modified Santiago case. And yet, the Commission on Elections came out with its own resolution akin to an IRR, which, as far as my interpretation is concerned, which provided some curative measures insofar as the inadequacy of previous COMELEC resolutions. Sa tingin niyo po ba, Chairman, mas mainam na gumawa na lang ng batas ang Kongreso to amend Republic Act 6735, which the Supreme Court termed as inadequate? And also in that decision, the Supreme Court stated that COMELEC should be permanently enjoined from entertaining or taking cognizance of any petition for initiative on amendments to the Constitution. Baguhin muna namin yung batas bago kayo gumawa ng COMELEC resolution, o ituloy nyo po yung paggawa ng COMELEC resolution, amyendahan nyo yung resolution 10650 circa 2020. Ano po yung the respected magistrates can jump in. Ano po yung mas mainam na gawin dito? Baguhin muna namin yung Congress should amend 6735 or COMELEC should amend resolution 10650. Para mas matibay po, para once and for all kung ano yung pagkukulang na nakita sa Santiago case na hindi naman na-tackle doon sa Lambino case, although meron 10 obiter doon. Ano po yung mas mainam sa tingin niyo po, Mr. Chairman?
Madam Chair, since ang COMELEC po under the Constitution, under Article 9C, Section 2, is just there to enforce and administer election law, we will highly respect whatever is the wisdom of Congress in this matter. Although we have our own opinion as regards Republic Act 6735 po, when it comes to whether it is sufficient or not, hindi po kasi kami pwede magsalita hanggang ngayon, sapagkat that will be the basis of any future resolution of the Commission in the event that a formal petition will be filed in the COMELEC. Kasama po yun sa sufficiency in form and substance, Madam Chair, Your Honors. And so, it's premature at this point for the COMELEC to jump in and make a statement as regards to the sufficiency or insufficiency of Republic Act 6735.
So, Mr. Chairman, wala po kayong rekomendasyon sa committee ito na baguhin na lang po na para siguradong-sigurado na tayo, kasi may provisions pa ako na encounter yung sa initiative. There is such a thing as direct initiative and indirect initiative. So hindi ba mas maganda ang klaruhin na lang ng panibagong batas ito para once and for all, the law will set the appropriate standards on how COMELEC should act, issue the appropriate resolution. Wala na ho tayong gulo. Kasi akit na naman po ito sa Supreme Court. Sasabihin na Supreme Court, mawalang galang na si kay Justice Ascuna, professor ko po ito, akit na naman sa Supreme Court. Sasabihin na naman sa Supreme Court, sinabi ko na sa inyo na ganito ito. Hindi na tayo matatapos dito.
Maganda pong suggestion talaga po kung magkakaroon ng pagbabago sa batas para maklarify na ang lahat. It should not be the COMELEC that should be clarifying anything. Our IRR should not be there to correct whatever mistakes, if there are, dun sa batas. Hindi po yun ang role ng implementing rules and regulation. Ang dapat
po
yung
happening right now, Mr. Chairman, is that the COMELEC will be correcting its previous IRR. And the previous IRR was made to supplant some loopholes found in RA 6735. So baguhin na lang natin 6735, tapos issue ng, or perhaps the Congress can make a very tight law na hindi na kailangan ng IRR. Kaya ko po sinasabi ito, Madam Chair, napakarami na pong pangyayari na yung IRR, iniba yung batas. Meron po akong encounter doon na wala na dito yung mga diptiga Department of Health, yung
Senator
Milk
Cole?
Code of the Philippines, binago nila.
So follow-up lang ako yes, yes. sa sinabi ninyo, okay lang. For all our legal luminaries, the justices who are here, perhaps you can help us. Perhaps the reason why COMELEC Resolution 10650 is so defective is because the law nga that is trying to implement it, RA 6735, is insufficient to cover the PI as conceived in the constitutional amendment. Could this be the case? Because in the decision of Lambino versus COMELEC, I believe the ponente being here, the Supreme Court categorically declined to revisit the Santiago ruling. Assuming for a moment that no motions for reconsideration were filed in Lambino, would you agree, Chairman Garcia, that the Santiago ruling remains valid? Because you have given interviews stating the contrary.
Madam Chair, Your Honors, this is a personal opinion as a former Dean of the College of Law and a former law professor. It will not bind the entire commission because it's being asked of me. With the kind indulgence of everybody, if we are going to read the case of Santiago versus Comelec, indeed, the voting was 8-6 in favor of insufficiency. However, Madam Chair, Your Honors, if you are going to read the motion for reconsideration, there was a sudden turnaround. It was a 6-6 voting, Madam Chair, Your Honors. In that 6-6 voting, Justice Hermosissima reversed himself and sided with the five who voted to declare 6735 as sufficient. And Justice Vitug refused to resolve Republic Act 6735 on its insufficiency or sufficiency. One justice inhibited himself, and the other justice said it's premature. That's why the voting after the motion for reconsideration.
But Chairman, the reality is, in its resolution of November 21, 2006, the Supreme Court dismissed all the MRs. Even if there was a sentence in that resolution saying that 10 members reiterated their position as shown by their various opinions, the decision is upheld as sufficient and adequate to amend through a people's initiative. Are you saying that this single sentence reverses the Santiago ruling?
Madam Chair.
Yes, let him answer, please.
Madam Chair, Your Honors, a reading of the dissenting opinion of Justice Panganiban, of Justice Renato Puno would reveal that what was mentioned in the decision as to be having an injunction, a permanent injunction, is the Delfin petition. It is never intended by the court to be a prohibition in future cases for purposes of the determination of the applicability
yes,
of 6735.
Yes, I don't think that's the question we're asking. It's very clear from the statement that the separate opinions of the 10 justices already mentioned had promulgated their opinions as early as October, before the MRs in November. Upon the resolution of the MR, the 10 justices merely reiterated what they had already said. So if the separate opinions of October 25, Lambino Ponencia, were not enough to overturn Santiago, how can the mere reiteration of these same opinions in November 21 suddenly overturn the entire Santiago doctrine?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
If I may, Madam Chair, just to add to the response of the good chairman to the chair's question, maybe the chair could also ask Justice Carpio to weigh in on this question.
Yes, Yamanak, I was Madam going chair. To allow Chairman Garcia, and then after that, of course, the very enlightened and personal knowledge of Justice Carpio. Yes, Chairman Garcia.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, Your Honors. As far as because we are talking now of the Lambino versus Comelec decision, indeed, the Supreme Court said that they are not at liberty at that time to depart from the ruling in the case of Santiago versus Comelec. But however, again, it's a subject to interpretation in the motion for reconsideration. There was this one paragraph which says that 10 justices of the Supreme Court are of the opinion that Republic Act 6735 is sufficient.
With the permission of the good chairperson. But as
still have the floor,
just on this point, Senator Trentino, But as lawyers too, Chairman Garcia, again, you're expressing your personal opinion and not in any way binding the commission. It is clearly obiter because it was not needed to dispose of the case. The case was already disposed of. That statement had nothing to do with the disposition of the case on the merits. Now, I will not bind you to an answer, but a lawyer can interpret that too in that manner, that although that statement was made in the minute resolution of Lambino, that is obiter insofar as the main case, which the court disposed of already. As Senator Marcos said, all of the cases and petitions were dismissed. It would be fair to interpret it that way as well. Would that be a fair statement?
Coming from a very respected legal luminary such as the Honorable Senator, we will definitely respect such a position. But thank of course, that will be the subject of a future litigation again in the Supreme Court. That's why, again, perhaps it's the best time that this legal issue be resolved with finality by the Honorable Supreme Court.
Thank you, Madam Chair. With the indulgence of Senator Tolentino.
Thank you very much. Yes. Senator Tolentino, would you like to invite Justice Carpio at this point?
Justice Carpio can join us.
Yes, Madam Chair, Your Honors. If you look at the main decision in Lambino, you have to look at the dispositive portion. The dispositive portion, which is the binding portion, says the petitions are dismissed. And then in the motion for recon, it's the resolution of the court says the MR is denied with finality. So there is no reversal of Santiago because you have to look at the dispositive portion. That is the portion that binds everybody. So the statement in the MR that 10 justices maintained their position is just a statement of what these 10 justices said, which was already ruled in the main decision. So the dispositive portion should prevail. And there is nothing in the dispositive portion that reverses Santiago. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the very simple and truly enlightening clarification, Justice Carpio. I know that you had a previous engagement and you made a real effort to join us, so thank you for your participation. It's been most enlightening and clarifies that, in fact, Lambino does not repeal or change the Santiago ruling. Thank you. Senator Tolentino, please.
No further questions, Madam Chair. Perhaps the next step for this Congress to do is amend Republic Act 6735, yeah, and then the Commission elections to issue appropriate resolutions to implement the amended law. Unless Justice Ascuna would want to say something, wala na po akong itatanong, Madam Chair. Salamat.
Maraming salamat, Senator Tol, and we'd like to call on Justice Ascuna, who's waited patiently from early this morning, if Senator Cheese will allow the justices to please first take the floor. Thank you, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In connection with the Lambino versus Comelec, I was one of the justices who voted in that case. I was one of those who, one of the 10, whose opinion was that Republic Act 6735 was sufficient to support an initiative to amend the Constitution. But the ruling was that there was no need to examine whether or not the Santiago ruling should be reviewed, because in that Lambino case, it was very clear that the proposal was a revision, and therefore it cannot be done by initiative. So the ruling was petition denied because it's one for revision. In the motion for reconsideration, it is true that there's the last paragraph that says that the 10 justices maintained their position that the law, Republic Act 6735, is sufficient. However, I believe that, although I was one of the 10, I believe that that is not a binding statement. It merely reiterated our obiter dictum, our academic opinion, what is not part of the ruling, because as the main decision said, it is not necessary to go into that. That is what Justice Holmes called economy of jurisprudence. You decide only what has to be decided. You reserve for future cases what needs to be decided so that it will not bind future Supreme Court. That is economy of jurisprudence. So I respect that. Madam Chair, if we had reverse our position and reverse Santiago, the dispositive portion would have partly granted the petition, not denied completely. It would have said, wherefore the petition is partly granted to the extent that Santiago versus Comelec is reversed. But the petition is denied because it is for revision. But we didn't do that. We denied the petition completely. So that means we did not go into the review of Santiago versus Comelec. The same with the motion for reconsideration. It was the dispositive portion said all the motions for reconsiderations are hereby denied. Otherwise, it would have said partly granted by reversing Santiago versus Comelec. We did not. So as Justice Carpio said, it's the dispositive portion that counts. And the dispositive portion in the Lambino case very clearly did not reverse or even touch upon Santiago versus Comelec. And therefore, I believe it still stands. Moreover, Madam Chair, the deficiencies pointed out by Chief Justice Davide in Republic Act 6735 in the Santiago versus Comelec case, that it is insufficient, inadequate, and incomplete. Why? Because it does not state what the petition should contain, whereas it states what the petition to make an ordinary law should contain. It does not state what a petition to amend the Constitution should state. Moreover, it says that the change shall be effective upon publication in the Official Gazette. Whereas in the case of an amendment of the Constitution, it is effective upon the plebiscite, approval in the plebiscite. So it is incomplete. There's no provision on the effectivity of the change. There's no provision on the content of the petition. Now, can the COMELEC supply that deficiency? I respectfully submit, Madam Chair, that the COMELEC cannot supply that deficiency. There has to be a law. Why? Because the Constitution says that Congress shall pass a law to implement this initiative. That's in Article 17. Congress is the one mandated to pass the law. And there is a principle in constitutional law called potestas delegata delegare non potes. Where the Constitution has put the power, it shall remain there. It cannot be transferred elsewhere. And so therefore, the COMELEC cannot do it. Moreover, under the provision of the Constitution on the COMELEC, the powers given to the COMELEC is to enforce and administer the law, not to complete it, not to perfect it, not to supply deficiencies, enforce and administer. So if it is incomplete, imperfect, inadequate, you cannot enforce it. You cannot administer it. There is a need for Congress to pass a law that is adequate, complete, and sufficient. In fact, there is a pending resolution of the pending bill in the Senate for that. Senator Coco Pimentel has a pending bill to correct the deficiencies of Republic Act 6735. I think that should be the case. Thank you very much,
Justice Ascuna. And assuming, without conceding, that RA 6735, I think perhaps you're the right person to ask, assuming that this is in fact sufficient for argument, to implement the constitutional provision on people's initiative, you made mention and distinguished between a mere amendment and a revision. I would like to ask you your opinion based on the signature sheets that have been passed around. What is being proposed in Section 1, Paragraph 1 of Article 7 of the Constitution is a change in voting jointly at the call of the Senate President or the Speaker of the House. Do we then consider that this is a an amendment or a revision of the structure of government and bicameralism?
Madam Chair, in my personal opinion, the proposed initiative now is not a mere amendment but a revision, because it affects Article 6 of the Constitution, not just Article 17, because it changes the nature of the legislative body from a bicameral one to a unicameral, in effect, because by voting jointly, the Senate and the House will become, in effect, a unicameral body. There is another provision in the existing Constitution which provides where Congress may vote jointly. That is during imposition of martial law. But that is in the existing provision. That was not introduced by initiative. If you want to change the voting, it has to be done by Constituent Assembly, not by initiative. And Constituent Assembly, you need the Senate to participate. That's why it cannot be done. So that's the problem. The problem I was testifying before the House of Representatives, their problem, Madam Chair, is paano naman kami? Approved na namin ito, ngunit ayaw ng Senado. I told them, well, you can't do anything because it has to be both of you. Now, if this is approved, assuming it's all right and it's approved by our people, and so now Article 17 will read that one of the ways of proposing amendments or even revisions to the Constitution is by a vote of Congress, by 3/4 of all its members voting jointly. Okay, does that mean that the Senate is out of the picture? I don't think so, because it says Congress, and Congress means Senate and House, and therefore you need at least 12 plus 1 senators to vote with the lower house for it to be a valid act of Congress. Because if there is no majority vote of the Senate in that, let's say you have 315 representatives and 24 senators, you have 339 in all, and 3/4 of that is 254. Of the 254, 13 has to be senators. Otherwise, it's not an act of Congress, because it's not an act of the Senate. And Congress is Senate and House. So even if you vote jointly, it has to be jointly with Senate and the House voting together. And if the Senate is not present, let's say there's no quorum on the part of the Senate, then even if the 315 congressmen vote in favor, it does not propose an amendment, because it's not Congress. It has to be both Senate and the House acting together, even if outvoted kayo. But there has to be a participation of the Senate, and that means at least a majority vote of the Senate. You can even change your rules, Madam President, Madam Chair. Your rules state that your quorum is majority plus one, or one half plus one. You should change that to say that if the matter being considered is a proposal to amend the Constitution, the quorum is 3/4 of the Senate. And if it is a matter of calling a constitutional convention, it is 2/3 of the Senate. And that's your quorum. So if none of you will attend the so-called call by the House Speaker, imagine the Speaker can call both the Senate and the House under the amendment. Supposing none of you will show up, or less than the quorum, they cannot proceed because there is no quorum. Now, if they cannot proceed, they'll order the arrest. The Speaker will order the arrest of a senator. Is that possible? So that is the problem, Madam President. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Justice Ascuna. And certainly in Lambino versus Comelec, the court stated that altering the principle of separation of powers or the system of checks and balances amounts to a revision, an entire revision that is not a mere amendment. I'd like to hear from the Comelec. Do you agree with this? Do the other legal experts like Dean Jokno and the rest agree with this?
Madam Chair, yes, Comelec, your Honours, with all due respect, that's premature at this point on the part of the Commission. There being no petition yet before the COMELEC, and we do not want to preempt the action of the Commission. It's just sufficient that we are listening intently on the statement and the opinion of Mr. Justice Ascunia and Justice Carpio.
I completely understand and respect the position taken by the good chair, given that this might be ripe for their own adjudication at the proper time, and it would be premature to ask for his opinion on the matter. Suffice it to say that the lecture given by our distinguished former justices and Chief Justice of the Supreme Court would more than suffice, especially given the fact that I will qualify them as to their expertise. Not only were they part of the Lambino case, but not only were they part of the Supreme Court that decided at that time, the ponente is Chief Justice Carpio himself. Kumbaga, sa pagtitingnan niyo yung intent ng Kongreso sa mga batas na ginagawa namin, parang ito na rin yung intent ng Korte Suprema, kumbaga, nung yung desisyon ay binaba at ginawad patungkol sa petisyon ng Lambino case. May I just ask one question to the distinguished COMELEC chairman for his consideration and for the COMELEC's consideration, Madam Chair?
Yes, please proceed. But in the meantime, of course, we also recognize that Justice Ascunia, in addition to his participation in the Supreme Court, was one of the framers of both the 1973 Constitution as well as the 1987 Constitution. And we are fortunate also to have the presence of Justice Carpio, the actual ponente of the Lambino case. Yes, please proceed, Senator Chis.
Now, may I confirm, Chairman Garcia, COMELEC is an independent constitutional body, right?
Madam Chair, Your Honor, yes, that's true.
So as such, you have fiscal autonomy. Would that be correct?
That is correct, Madam Chair.
As such, you're given by the power under the Constitution to realign funds within the COMELEC's budget. Would that be correct?
That is correct, Madam Chair.
Now, given that your original budget proposal to the DBM, when you were asked to submit a budget proposal during the budget call, was 43.716 billion, and the DBM only gave you 27.103 billion. There is a differential that you would have wanted to utilize for purposes of performing your functions as a constitutional body. Would that be correct?
That is correct, Madam Chair, 17.4 billion.
Now, specifically, you proposed 2.57 billion for the conduct of supervision of elections, referenda, recall votes, and plebiscites. Would that be correct? You proposed that?
2.5 million, yes, Madam Chair.
And then all of a sudden, the BICAM recommended 14 billion, which actually increased it by 12 billion. Would that be correct?
12 billion for the conduct of recall initiative, referendum, and other election preparation, and 1 billion for the preparatory national and local elections.
Yes. And yet you had other submissions for capital outlay and for PS that were not granted.
That's right, Madam Chair.
So, as you stated earlier, now that for the information of everyone, given that it was stated by Senate President Zubiri, now that the President has taken a position against People's Initiative and you are reviewing the rules of COMELEC with respect to the supposed law of 6735, would there be a possibility that the COMELEC will revisit the 14 billion item in your budget, realign it for the purpose of spending it on what you really need, on capital outlay and PS, that is the creation of positions, which is well within your power to do so. Would that be correct?
Madam Chair, Your Honor, and this is for the record, even before the NBank had voted yesterday to suspend any and all proceedings, including the effectivity of our COMELEC Resolution 10650, we already had in our mind the items by which this 13 billion pesos to be spent, and definitely all of these items which this representation is willing to submit to this committee does not pertain to any People's Initiative or any plebiscite in relation thereto.
Can you submit, Mr. Chair, once it is done, the realignment of COMELEC insofar as these allocations are concerned? Again, given that COMELEC, as an independent constitutional body, can realign from within your agency, given the direction given by the President as well, and how things are running.
Yes, Madam Chair, Your Honors, we will do that. In fact, we will return to the items which were reduced in as far as the amount is concerned, ibabalik po namin lahat, yung lahat ng nawala sa amin.
Kindly inform us when this is done, Mr. Chairman.
Definitely, Madam Chair, Your Honors.
Now,
thank you very
on the resolution to suspend further consideration of this people's initiative, the ground given was that you would review your rules. Would that be correct?
That is correct, Madam Chair, Your Honors.
For the information of the good COMELEC Chair, there are several petitioners, including the Senate, who are planning to seek a clarificatory ruling, as may be necessary from the Supreme Court, because as stated by Justice Azcuna, how can you come up with rules for a law that is inadequate and insufficient? Although I acknowledge the fact that these rules were issued prior to your term as Chairman of the Commission on Elections.
That's right, Mr. Chair, Madam Chair, Your Honors, but the suspension of our rules does not preclude anybody going to the higher court to question the same rule that we suspended.
Again, just informing the good chairman that there are such plans to go up before the Supreme Court to precisely question that. And perhaps this would be considered as a condition precedent given a pendency of a case should that time arise this week or next week for the COMELEC to be more prudent in issuing new ones until, if at all, those cases are resolved when the time should come.
Definitely, Madam Chair, Your Honors, we will seriously consider the suggestion of the good senator.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. Senator Tolentino, please.
Yes, a manifestation.
And thereafter, Senator Risa, is that correct? Thank you.
Yes, a manifestation of gratitude. I'd like to thank Justice Escarpio and Azcuna for clarifying all of this as a constitutional law junkie. I think, Madam Chair, I think we have to really, really assert the Senate's right to implement Article 6, Section 16 of the Constitution, which refers to, and I quote, each house shall determine the rules of its proceedings. And this has been affirmed several times with the Supreme Court itself. Maraming salamat po sa dalawa po nating ginagalang na maestrado.
Maraming salamat. And Senator Risa, I'd also like to invite at the earliest opportunity, Dean Cheldocno. Thank you, Senator Risa, please.
Yamanak, Madam Chair, with also thanks to Justices Azcuna and Carpio. Just to follow on the one of the statements of Justice Azcuna, Madam Chair, for the record, could we get also the COMELEC's position on the proposal contained in the alleged people's initiative? Amendment po ba yon o revision? Yung proposed phrase po na voting jointly.
Madam Chair, Your Honors, at this point po, talagang umihingi kami ng paumanhin. We cannot render any opinion as regards to this to that statement as contained in the signature sheet simply because hanggang ngayon po, yung mga papel po na naandyan sa aming mga local COMELEC, these are mere scrap of papers. Wala pa pong visa, wala pa pong kwenta, wala pa pong value until and unless these documents will be used in a formal petition to be filed with the Commission on Elections. So as far as we are concerned, we did not even look into the entire content of the form. Ang tinignan lang po namin doon, numbers, and yung number of pages.
Thank you, good chair, Madam Chair. Although I would have wished maybe the good chair might have ventured an opinion even as a professor, but if he wishes, then I will just leave it at that for now. Dahil napag-usapan din with Sanchez yung usapin ng budget, nabanggit rin po ng ilang COMELEC officials na kung magpatuloy ang proseso ng People's Initiative, ay ang gastos dito ay aabot sa 13 billion pesos na magdudulot di umano ng financial crisis sa Commission. Sang-ayon po ba ang good chair sa statement po na iyon?
Madam Chair, Your Honors, tama po. Simply because we cannot divert anymore any of the funds in the possession of the COMELEC or is contained in the GAA, the General Appropriations Act. Kasi po, napakaliit na po na nabigay sa amin preparatory for the national and local election. Take note, Madam Chair, Your Honors, hindi po nafa-factor in ng lahat yung barangay and SK elections ng 2025. There was the Supreme Court decision which mandated the Commission, directed the Commission to conduct the BSKE by December of 2025, 5 months only after the conduct of the May 2025 national and local elections. Nung mag-prepare po na kami ng budget, Madam Chair, Your Honors, hindi pa po naka-factor in yung BSKE simply because lumabas po yung decision ng Supreme Court only after the budget had been transmitted and transmitted by the executive to the legislative department. And so, napakalaking blessing po sa amin na naibalik yung 12 billion so that we can spend that for the preparation for these two elections for 2025.
Tamat, good share, Madam Chair. So kahit ayaw pang mag-delve ang COMELEC into some of the substantive issues regarding this people's initiative, at least klaro na rin po sa committee namin na mayroong napaka-konkretong mga financial implications kung sakasakali. Isang tanong na lang po, Madam Chair, sa good share, bago yung unang tanong ko kay Dean Chell Jokno. Mr. Chair, kung ipilit po ipagpatuloy yung People's Initiative at pagdaraos din ng verification at plebisito sa ilalim ng COMELEC, paano po ito makakaapekto sa COMELEC, lalo na malapit na yung binanggit din ng Chair na 2025 elections?
Madam, maraming salamat po, Madam Chair, your honors, and this is an opportunity for the COMELEC to clarify. We cannot conduct any plebiscite in 2025. That's a no-no, that's a negative. We cannot conduct the plebiscite by November of this year to December of this year. Napakaliit na po ng space na ginagalawan po ng commission election. Everybody should be able to understand that when you conduct a plebiscite or even a national or even a local elections, you need such procedural, yung processes for procurement. Saan po kami kukuha ng millions ng ballpen ngayon? Hindi po pwede sa PSDBM, hindi po nila kaya yon. Paano po kami po-procure ng papel para po sa pagpe-print ng balota? You can only do that if the COMELEC is able to declare after a very tedious process that indeed the 12% signatures were had as far as those who wanted to amend the constitutions are concerned. And number two, the 3% per legislative district. So napakahaba pa pong proseso niya. Meron pa po kami determination supposedly under the rules that we have suspended of the sufficiency or insufficiency of the petition. Eh sabi ko nga po, baka pag-file pa lang po ng petition nila, kulang yung kanila pong petition, we will dismiss immediately if that is not sufficient informed substance. So we have nothing to verify at all. So mahabang proseso pa po yun, and that process, in accordance with our rules, will take several months. And therefore, come to think of it, yung pwede lang po kami mag-conduct ng plebisito sa kasalukuyan, Madam Chair, Your Honors, ay October of this year. But however, October po, filing na po tayo ng certificates of candidacy. And therefore, magkakasabay po yung mga trabahong ginagawa ng COMELEC, more particularly, Your Honors, yung registration of voters natin, which we have to start by February 12 up to September 30 of this year. Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat din po, good share, Madam Chair. So again, bagamat hindi pa kinakaya ng COMELEC mag-delve into some ilang mga substantive issues kaugnay nitong People's Initiative, sa huling sagot ng good share, Madam Chair, malinaw na may mga limitasyon to what is humanly or institutionally possible sa given yung ibang mga nakaatas na natungkulin sa COMELEC even until next year or the year 2025. So maraming salamat po, good share, Madam Chair. Kung maaari ko pong i-pose yung unang tanong ko, Madam Chair, kay Dean Chell.
Madam Chair, if I may.
Yes, Madam Chair.
I'm sorry, with the indulgence of my distinguished colleague.
Yes, Madam.
Just to clarify something on the part of the Commission on Election, if I may, Madam Chair.
Yes, the sufferance indulgence of Senator Risa, our yes, majority Chair. Leader, Senator Villanueva.
Yes, thank you very much, Madam Chair. Thank you, Senator Risa. This is not going to be, this is not going to take long. First of all, Madam Chair, let me state for the record my sincerest thanks and appreciation to our justices who came here and gave us a very enlightening statements. Justice Ascuna, Justice Carpio, napakalaking tulong po ninyo sa bayan, lalo po sa mga estudyante ng kasaysayan at estudyante ng pag-aaral ng ating saligang batas, ng ating mga batas. Klaro sa akin, what is now binding, and ang binding, yung main decision, hindi yung dissenting opinion. Klaro din po sa akin yung binanggit nyo kung bakit ang importante na pumunta tayo dun sa basic na premise kung paano in-structure ang ating mga institusyon gaya ng Senado at Kamara de
de representantes, which we all, marami po sa amin dito sa Senado galing, kaya mahal namin ang HOR. At ito yung dahilan kung bakit importante talaga yung voting separately at magkaroon ng checks and balance. Babalikan ko po yung mga ilang katanungan sa ating Commission on Elections. First of all, we also like to say that it's a welcome development. Ito pong inisyu ng COMELEC and Bank para ho isuspend yung all processes relating to the People's Initiative. Chairman George, maraming beses narinig natin ang COMELEC at ang mga opisyalis nito na sinasabi na receiving signature sheets is a ministerial duty of the COMELEC. However, ito nga po yung COMELEC nag-announce that it is indefinitely suspending the receipt of signature sheets after 209 out of 253 legislative districts have submitted their signature sheets. We just want to understand this very clearly, you know. Sabi nung una, it is ministerial, ngayon pinapahinto. Does this mean that the receipt of signature sheets is not ministerial, really, on the part of COMELEC? And that's the reason why COMELEC and Bank came up with this decision, Madam Chair?
Madam Chair, Your Honor, still ministerial, simply because that's part of the guidelines or the rules under 10650. That's the first part po. Although, again, we'd like to reiterate that at that point of the receipt by our local COMELEC of these signature pages or forms, the COMELEC cannot or had not yet exercised jurisdiction.
Okay, sir, we're not in verifying yet, but in just receiving. So isn't it this decision on how or when the duty shall be performed, which makes it discretionary on the part of the COMELEC? Ang point ko lang, Madam Chair, is I wanted to be clarified. Kailan ba ministerial, kailan discretionary? Kasi ho, maraming nagtatanong, and I'm not a lawyer, Your Honor, Madam Chair, parang sa korte ba pwede kang magbigay ng mga attachments, tapos sasabihin mo, to follow na yung aking kaso, no? Parang ganun ho yung dating sa akin kung magre-receive ka na magre-receive. And while you were receiving these documents and signatures, hindi mo alam kung may mga nagtatanong na, may mga nasa news na nagbibigay ng salapi, mayroong tumutulak na staff ng kongresista, etc. And we can go on with all these pieces of evidence that we have collected here. So ang point ko lang, Madam Chair, is that hindi ba once and for all kailangang mapag-desisyonan? Ito ba ay ministerial or discretionary?
Madam Chair, Your Honor, sabi po ng kagalang-galang Supreme Court at napakadami ng decision, basta po ministerial, no discretion. We have no choice but to perform such a duty. In fact, yung po ministerial duty can be the subject of a petition for mandamus to compel the performance thereof. Pagka po discretionary, we can refuse to perform such a duty. Ngayon po, para po magkaroon ng clearer understanding ng ating mga kababayan, dito po sa pagtanggap ng mga signature forms. Wala po itong pinagkaiba, Madam Chair, Your Honor, sa pagtanggap ng COMELEC ng mga certificates of candidacy. Yan po ministerial duty. Kung ang nagpapail po ng kandidatura isang 25 anyos para sa kandidato for president, we have no choice but to accept that certificate of candidacy. But it doesn't mean that the COMELEC is now giving due course to that certificate of candidacy. Nangangahulugan, pwede po namin yung i-reject agad after matanggap kasi lumalabas, ineligible naman pala yung nagpa-file ng candidacy. But refusing to accept the candidacy, or in this case, the signature forms, baka pumakasuhan yung aming mga local COMELEC sapagkat, again, ministerial po yung duty in accordance with COMELEC Resolution 10650, which we suspended in view of one of these issues po. Yung issue po yan, yung inyo pong nabanggit, Madam Chair, Your Honors.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Chairman George. No? Yesterday also COMELEC announced that it has received signature forms from 1,072 cities and municipalities as January 26, 2024. Now, based on COMELEC Resolution Number 10650, the election officer will issue a certification using Annex B of the resolution. Now, looking at Annex B, nakalagay po dito, may nakuha po tayong dokumento. It specifically says that the proponents submitted signatures of registered voters as petitioners in this petition. So, does this mean that there is already a petition? If there is no petition yet, when
what petition is the election officer certifying to, Madam Chair?
Yes, Madam Chair, Your Honors. Wala pa pong formal na petition that will trigger the performance of or the exercise of jurisdiction of the Commission election. Perhaps what is being referred there, kaya nga po namin sinuspend para maklarify ang lahat, para po mas specific at maayos. Perhaps what is being referred there is the signature form, is the petition by itself. Remember po in the ponencia of Mr. Justice Carpio, it's in the first page ng kanyang ponente po, ang sabi po niya, kaya dinidismiss yung petition doon sa case na yon sapagkat signature forms lang po siya, ni walang nakalagay, basta pirma ng mga tao. So sabi po doon sa ponente, ng ponente, dapat po yung mismong signature form should contain the provision of the Constitution subject of the amendment. So siguro po of the proposal, siguro po yun ang nire-refer ng Annex B na yan ng aming COMELEC Resolution 10650.
Sige po, Chairman, no? Just to be clarified again. You look at your decision, paragraph 2 of the said memorandum, it states that signature sheets which have already been submitted before the aforementioned date must be safeguarded and their integrity preserved by the concerned election officers until further orders are issued by the Commission. Now, paragraph 3 of your decision, says the proponent can retrieve the signature sheets provided that he or she return the certification. And I suppose this pertains to this Annex B that we just got from our friends. And perhaps if you can also look into this, yung certification, if we have a slide that we can show na ito ay talagang galing po sa Commission on Election, kasi Annex B po ito. Are you
yes, Madam Chair, Your Honors, tama po yung Annex B na yan. Yan yung certification na ini-issue ng mga election officers ng municipalities and cities once they receive the signature forms. And usually po ay dalawang kopya po yan. Yung isang kopya ay binibigay po doon sa nagdala ng mga signature forms or signature pages sa kanya. At pangalawa po ay yung pinapadala niya sa aming clerk of court. And that's why we can be able to monitor ilan na po yung naipapareceive sa aming mga signatures and at the same time kung ano mga bayan na katulad po na nabanggit nyo kanina ang nakatanggap na ng mga signature forms based doon sa sinuspend namin na COMELEC Resolution 10650.
Madam Chair, if we can also ask COMELEC to give us a copy of these certifications. How many certifications have you issued? Kasi ho, ito, certification na to, Annex B na po ito. So, ibig sabihin, I suppose, may Annex A?
Ay, yung Annex A, Madam Chair, Your Honors, yun yung certification from our Election Records and Statistics Department of how many registered voters are there in the entire country. And how many registered voters are there on a per legislative district of the 253 legislative district nationwide?
And can we see a sample, Madam Chair, of an issued certification signed by an EO?
Yes, Madam Chair, we are willing to submit a sample copy of the certification issued by our election officer.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. At kung maaari po, makahingi po tayo ang committee na ito nitong certification ito. Maraming salamat, Chairman George.
Madam Chair, and this is a clarification addressed to the good Senator, Majority Floor Leader. What particular province and municipality would a good Senator would like to be given a copy of the certification?
Ito po sana, itong certification na ito. Na, of course, siyempre, lahat gusto natin. No? But itong certification na Annex B.
Yeah, yes, Madam Chair. That's the form. Natin. That's the form, Madam Chair. But the good Majority Floor Leader was talking about a sample of the certification.
I would love to see the province of Bulacan, Your Honor.
On this point, Madam Chair, may we request for all, Chairman Garcia, is this a private document, the certification of the election officer, or is it a public document?
Because it was already sent to our, and we received already that sent to our clerk of court, then it's these are already public documents.
Who sent it to the clerk of court, the EO?
The election officers, Madam Chair, certified through copies of the original copies given to the proponent or to whoever have delivered the signature form.
Well, perhaps there is indeed a reason to revise and revisit your rules, because based on my reading of the rules, it says that these certifications will be part of the annex of the petition.
That's
it's
right.
Not the petition itself.
That's right, Madam Chair. And that's
so
why
the petition is separate from the annex. And if that is so, why is the COMELEC the one sending the petitions to the main office of COMELEC para mas madaling stapler nung, hindi ba obligasyon ng petitioner to gather, when, upon submission, to gather the certifications? Of course, merong on file ang COMELEC.
Madam Chair, honors, kaya po dalawang kopya, yung original po, yung po yung nasa proponent o kung sino nagbibigay. And then, the election officer will have to send a copy
for validation,
for validation later in the event that a formal petition will be filed to COMELEC and will be used yung mga binigay namin certification ng mga local COMELEC as Annex B.
As an annex, di ba?
Yes, Madam Chair.
Yung signature sheets will not even be an annex yet.
That's right.
Right? It will remain in the offices of the EO.
That's right, Madam Chair.
Now that you've suspended it, what will happen to them?
Nakalagay po doon sa binasa, Madam Chair, ng ating kagalang-galang na Majority Floor Leader, either i-retrieve nila, ibalik nila sa amin yung mga certifications na inisyo namin, or pabayaan po nilang nasa mga opisina namin. We will just take care of
I understand that. But I would like to clarify, Chairman Garcia, may expiration date ba itong mga pinirmahan?
Wala po, Madam Chair.
So, pwedeng gamitin next year?
Depende po sa proponent if they will maintain the same provision of the Constitution that they wanted to amend, or they will be proposing a different provision of the Constitution.
So, magbabago lang kung may namatay, nag-abroad, o hindi na nakatira doon, o hindi bumoto ng tatlong beses, o tatanggalin na sa voters list, yun lang yung magbabago doon.
That's right, Madam
But
Chair.
This exact same document that they have gathered thus far has no expiry date.
That's right, Madam Chair, Your Honors.
Thank you for that clarification, Chairman Garcia.
Madam Chair.
Yes, thank you very much. Senator Bongo has been very patiently waiting, and I have failed to acknowledge him. We acknowledge his presence from much earlier on. By the way, we are at the deadline of 2 o'clock, and I'd like to remind Mr. Oñate, we are requesting the donors list. Do you have it now? Hiningi ni Minority Leader yung donors list doon sa TV ad, yung 55 million po. Nasa inyo na yung donors list po.
As I mentioned earlier, I provided the bulk of the funds and the rest is given by donors, and my lawyers are the ones that will prepare the list.
Madam Chair, if I may.
Yes, Senator Cheese, please.
We are willing to give additional time for you to get the consent too, of talk to your donors and get their acquiescence. But as I said earlier, they should have nothing to be ashamed or embarrassed about. May I just assure and ensure?
Next hearing, my lawyers will submit it.
May I just ensure the attendance of Mr. Oñate, because like Attorney Abad, you might go abroad again. When are you slated to go abroad again, Mr. Oñate?
Yes, yes.
When will you go abroad again, Mr. Oñate? I understand you're not really based here, so baka...
When will I go abroad?
Yes, because you're not based here, right? So baka delikadong pag nag-hearing kami.
I live here. It's just that I travel every now and then.
But I
live here. I live here in Manila.
Because you said earlier, yung sa DASMA nyo, walang nakatire.
Yeah, that's different because I use that as for entertainment. Yeah.
But you have a different residence.
Yes.
Mas maganda yung bahay mo kaysa sa entertainment?
Yes.
No, just wanted to make sure, Madam Chair, that you're not based in any way in San Francisco, as I've heard. You're not based in San Francisco.
I have a slight hearing problem. In fact, I'm wearing a hearing aid. That's why I am not.
It's okay, sir.
Sometimes I cannot hear properly.
It's okay, sir. You're based here in the Philippines and not in San Francisco.
Yes, I'm based here, but it's just that I go abroad every now and then.
Exactly. You're not a resident of San Francisco. You're a resident of the Philippines.
I maintain a residence in San Francisco, but I live here.
You're a green card holder,
no? I go there every now and then.
You're a green card holder or ordinary visa lang?
No, I'm not. I just maintain a residence in San Francisco.
And an entertainment house in Dasma.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. We expect your attendance in the next hearing, sir. Thank you, sir.
Madam Chair.
Madam Chair.
Senator Risa, please.
Gyamanak, Madam Chair. Just to ask my last couple of questions to Attorney Chel Jokno. Bilang human rights lawyer, ano bang mga karapatang pantao yung pwedeng maapektuhan ng CHATCHA or particularly ng People's Initiative?
Thank you, Madam Chair, Your Honors. Actually, kung sa People's Initiative po yan, it would depend on what the proposal is for an amendment. At klarong-klaro naman na hindi pwede naman i-revise ang ating konstitusyon sa pamamaraan ng People's Initiative. But if I may also address, Madam Chair, the statement made by the COMELEC Chair that they have a ministerial duty to accept the signature sheets, my understanding of the law is that the COMELEC has a ministerial duty to accept a petition, but not signature sheets alone that are not accompanied by a petition. I believe the COMELEC Chair himself said that the signature sheets are a mere scrap of paper, in which case, how can there be a ministerial duty to accept mere scraps of paper? So I think that should also be pointed out. And if I may also, Madam Chair, aside from the lack of a complete enabling law, the fact that the proposed amendment is a revision, that the signature sheets themselves are nothing, and they should never have been even accepted from the beginning by the COMELEC, in my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Attorney Chel.
One last question, Jokno. Madam Chair, for Attorney
maybe we
Chel.
Give the COMELEC an opportunity yes, to Madam respond Chair. Also to that, because I did hear the COMELEC chairman say that without the petition, the signature sheets are mere scraps of paper. So why did you accept these scraps of paper?
Madam Chair, simply because it's provided for in COMELEC Resolution 10650, which we suspended in order to resolve issues such as this one. Whether or not, for purposes of the People's Initiative, whether or not really the petition should come first or the signature form should come first ahead of the petition. That is one of the issues that should be resolved. Alin po ba talaga ang dapat mauna? Ang petition bago ang signature sheets o ang signature sheets bago ang formal na petition? So, yan po yung isang issues na kinakailangan i-resolve, and that's the reason why isa po yan sa mga bagay na pinag-usapan ng NBank para po mas maging maliwanag kung alin ba talagang una sa at huli sa dalawa.
Madam Chair. Pero dami-dami na ninyong tinanggap eh. I think si Senator Bato has been aching to talk.
Madam Chair, thank you, Madam Chair. Chairman George, habang nag-hearing tayo ngayon, marami tayong mga kababayan na nanonood at meron nang nagbabalak na bawiin yung kanilang signature. Will the COMELEC allow this? And if you allow this, paano bang gagawin nila? Saan sila pupunta? Pupunta pa ba sila sa purok, sa barangay, sa COMELEC, sa police station, o ano pong gagawin nila para mabigyan natin ng linaw yung paano nila gawin ito?
Madam Chair, you, Madam Chair, Your Honors, maraming salamat po. Yung po ang kadahilanan kung bakit sinuspend din namin ang rules sapagkat wala pong provision sa COMELEC Resolution 10650 ng procedure ng withdrawal ng mga signatures. For example, pupunta ang isang pumirma doon po sa signature sheet doon sa local COMELEC natin. Sure po ako kung naandyan yung rules namin, hindi po papayagan, Madam Chair, Your Honors, ng aming local COMELEC sapagkat wala pong nakalagay doon sa aming pong 10650 kung paano magwi-withdraw. At the same time, hindi wala pong form sa withdrawal. So ibig sabihin po, pagka tinignan nyo ng isang independent person yung mismong aming rules, as if hindi siya pumapayag na may mag-withdraw na kahit na isa doon sa mga signatories.
Mabuti at sinuspend din nyo dahil kung ganun, napakaraming Pilipino ang nababayulit yung kanilang karapatan na bawiin yung kanilang perma. Napakaraming gustong bumawi ng perma ngayon. So, mabuti sinuspend din nyo, Madam Chair, at klaro tayo na yun pala ay hindi nila pwedeng bawiin. Kahit nasabihin, Kahirap naman, no? Kung mahirap ka lang, no? Pobre ka lang ba? Naisahan ka lang. Now, sige, magpirma kayo dito. Bibigyan kayo ng AX bukas ng 3,000 pesos. Punta kayo, pirma kayo dito. Tapos ngayon, na-realize mo, because of this hearing, na-realize mo na mali pala yung ginawa ko. Yung palang pirma ko ay bininta ko na palang kaluluwa ng Pilipinas doon. Gusto kong bawiin. Tapos hindi pala pwedeng bawiin kung hindi ninyo sinuspend yung ginagawa ninyo. So that will result to something very bad para sa mga tao, lalo sabihin, porque mahirap lang kami. Hindi na pala namin pwedeng bawiin yung impirma. Nagkamali lang kami doon dahil naguyo kami doon sa inutusan ni Congressman na magpapirma sa amin. Tapos ganun, hindi na pala namin pwedeng bawiin. So, tama, napakahirap po sa isang ordinaryong Pilipino.
Tama po, Madam Chair, Honors. Kaya po, nararapat lamang na hindi muna maipatupad yung rules na yan upang mapagbigyan yung mga ganyan pong... Katulad din po, halimbawa, Madam Chair, Your Honors, yung issue ng pwede bang may observer o watcher during the verification. Wala po sa provision ng aming rules, yung COMELEC Resolution 10650. Kunyari lang din po, yung aming pong election officer nag-ruling na ito ay signature ni A at ito ay siya ay registered voter kahit naman hindi niya signature yon. Alam niyo po ba sa rules, final po yon. And therefore, wala rin pong mode ng appeal doon po sa aming COMELEC Resolution 10650. So, madami pong mga dapat na ayusin sapagkat we will have to ensure due process and that exercise of the rights of the people who are signing or not signing the signature sheets as well as the petition.
But given that the chairman has watched the videos, has listened to the witnesses, it's very clear that many of those who signed were misled and deceived. You are convinced that, in fact, a procedure for withdrawing signatures when they were extracted so illegally and unethically should be included in the new rules.
Mr. Madam Chair, dapat lang po, including po yung issue ng signature buying. Kasi sa issue po na signature buying, wala po rin nakalagay doon kung paano. For example, meron pong ebidensya laban na si A, ang kanyang pirma ay produkto ng pamimili o pagbibigay sa kanya kung anuman pong binibigay ng pamahalaan. Wala rin pong sinasabi na dapat tanggalin yung pangalan ni A doon sa signature page at payagan na hindi dapat ibilang siya doon sa pagdetermine ng 3% or 12%.
Salamat
Madam Chair,
po.
Madam Chair.
And, si
if
Senator
I may
Bongo,
lang po, with the permission Senator of the good chair. Since nabanggit po kanina ni Senator Escudero na walang expiry po itong mga signatures na collect, no? Ang tanong ko lang po sa inyo dito. Bakit ngayon lang naisipan ninyo ang bank na i-suspend muna ang proceedings at naging divisive eh. Medyo nagkagulo. Hindi nga tayo aabot dito kung hindi na, earlier pa po na address na po itong problema ito. Bakit po recently lang po na-suspend yung proceedings at bakit hindi nyo muna pinlansa ng mabuti itong mga rules ninyo bago pinatuloy yung pagkolekta. At yung tanong dyan is, inaantayan ng mga kababayan natin yung expiry nito. Until walang klarong sagot mula sa COMELEC, ay wala pong tuldok itong naging divisive na issue na ito.
Madam Chair, Your Honors, with your kind indulgence, Commissioner Ray Bulay would like to answer the query of the good Senator Bongo.
Commissioner Bulay, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. With the indulgence of the good Senator, idol ko po si Senator Bongo, Senator Bato. Ang simula po kami tumanggap ng papel, second week ng January. Ngayon po, January 30. Ang COMELEC po, ngayon in the thick of preparations for 2025, and not a single document came to our office. Hanggang ngayon, wala po. And yung aaralin pa namin, yung batas tungkol dito, hindi ho madaling gawin. Kasi po, nagpiprepare kami sa 2025 elections. na yun po ay babaguhin ang sistema. So dumating po ito, second week ng January this year. Ngayon po, January 30 lang tayo eh. Mabilis pa nga ho yung aming aksyon considering yung workload na dinadaanan po namin ngayong Enero. Kaya humihingi po kami ng paumanhin kung hindi po kami nakakilos agad. Pero sana po maintindihan na hindi lang po yun ang aming ginagawa. And true to the heart, hindi po namin gusto na irab ang common Filipino ng kanilang karapatan. We will not stand to that.
Madam Chair, ako po ay
napapasalamat, Madam Chair, sa oras na ako nakapagsalat.
Meron ho ba kayong formal complaint na natanggap sa mga naiulat na panunuhol in exchange for signature? Chair?
Madam Chair, Your Honors, as of this time po, wala po. At as of this time din po, wala pa rin natatanggap ang aming pong mga local COMELEC nationwide doon po sa mga 1,800 municipalities and cities na nagwi-withdraw ng kanilang signature. Simply because nga, siguro nga po dahil na-i-announce kahapon, na suspended naman ang lahat ng proseso. So again, in answer to your query, Madam Chair, Your Honors, wala pa po kaming natatanggap na kahit na anong complaint.
Since nabanggit niyo rin po, Mr. Chairman, na noong mga nakaraang araw, di ba, may mga pronouncement kayo na bawal po yung panunuhol in exchange for the signature. Since wala kayong natatanggap na complaint, wala ho ba kayong ginawang pag-imbestiga sa mga field offices niyo po?
Madam Chair, kapag po tinira natin yung mga umiiral ng mga patakarang, kahit po ang Omnibus Election Code, na under Republic Act 6735 ay supletory in character. Ibig sabihin, pwedeng gamitin namin. Alam niyo po, sa punto ng signature gathering, wala pa pong jurisdiction ng COMELEC. Doon po sa issue ng panunuhol o paggamit ng pondo, wala po kaming jurisdiction. Hindi po siya ma-relate kahit anong stretch ng aming imagination. Yun nga po yung pilit naming sinusubukan na magawa ng paraan. Kasi yung pong issue ng sinasabing vote buying, papasok lang po kasi ang vote buying, Madam Chair, Your Honors, kapag po election period. Yan po yung jurisdiction ng COMELEC. And therefore, when it comes to misuse of public funds in relation to signature buying, ang COMELEC po ay walang jurisdiction. The most po, magkakaroon kami ng jurisdiction kapag naando na kami sa level ng verification. Pag bine-verify na namin ang signatures, then tsaka po kami mag-entertain na si A, si B, si C, ang buong barangay na ito, kinuhanan ng signatures, binili ang kanilang mga pirma. Pwede po namin ma-entertain. Pero nga po, hanggang ngayon, the COMELEC does not have jurisdiction yet. Even at the time of the suspension of all proceedings, wala pa po kaming jurisdiction. Kaya nga po, siguro po, for purposes of legislation, yan po yung dapat maisama kung talagang re-reviewin po natin yung Republic Act 6735. Kasi po, the COMELEC cannot punish an act as criminal. The COMELEC po does not have that authority to define a crime. Meron po tayong prinsipyo sa batas, nullium crimen, nulla pena sine lege. There is no crime if there is no law punishing it. So how can we, the COMELEC, punish or even charge somebody violating something or performing an act which to us, under common understanding, is illegal or immoral kung hindi po siya punishable. Siguro po under the Anti-Graft and Corrupt Practices Act, but not under the Omnibus Election Code.
Marami po, marami ang listahan dito kung anong pwedeng ipataw na parusa na kahit sinasabi ninyo na wala sa batas, napakarami po nito.
At, Madam Chair,
andito yung mga iba't ibang anti-graft, yung revised penal code, ang 2020, may technical malversation po, may corruption of public officials, section 4, andito yung code of ethical conduct natin, yung admin problems, ang dami po rito, tapos yung direct bribery, lahat yan pwede, di ba? So, hindi pwedeng maghugas kamay. Talagang may mga batas na pwedeng gamitin.
We fully agree with the list as mentioned as far as violation of 3019, Republic Act 6713, or even the Administrative Code of the Philippines. Opa. Pero, Your Honor, yung pong violation sa Omnibus Election Code, ay unfortunately wala po.
Tama. Nagkakaintindihan po tayo dyan, pero hindi pwede maghugas kamay na walang ipataw na parusa sa mga gumawa nito. Si Senator Risa lang po.
Salamat, Madam Chair. One last follow-up question kay Attorney Chel Jocno, related dun sa line of questioning ng Chair. Bukod sa mga batas na nabanggit na ng Chair, Attorney Chel, bilang criminal lawyer, ano pa bang mga kaso ang pwedeng ihain sa mga taong mapatunayang ginamit, inabuso ang public authority o funds para sa isang huwad na people's initiative?
Thank you, Madam Chair, Your Honor. Kung ang if the public funds were used for another purpose other than what they were intended for, yan po ay papasok sa malversation. Kung sa anti-graft naman, maari din yan kasi meron na pagbabawal doon to induce another public officer to commit any violation of rules and regulations or the law. So yun po yung dalawa. Nandiyan din po yung RA 6713, Code of Conduct. Even the Ease of Doing Business Act actually has a penal clause that prohibits the giving of government services for a condition that's not in any law. So marami po talagang pwedeng kaso ang isang pa.
Salamat, Attorney Chel. Agyamanak, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. And I think we'll have to wind down, but a quick word from Congressman Marcoleta. We have session at 3 o'clock.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I wish to take advantage of the presence of our distinguished former associate justices of the Supreme Court, when in particular they say that the amended the recommended amendment to the Constitution by the People's Initiative is more of a revision than an amendment, citing that it will violate Section or Article 6 of the Philippine Constitution. Madam Chair, the way this is my personal opinion. When we call for the congressional or the constituent assembly, it's the first mode to amend the Constitution or revise the Constitution. It says amendment to or revision of this Constitution may be proposed by 1. The Congress upon 3/4 vote of all its members. So I'll proceed from that. When the Constitution simply say of all the members of Congress, it takes the totality of the members of the House of Representatives and then the Senate. Paano po yun, Justice Ascuna or Justice Carpio? Ang sabi po ninyo, if for example the members of the Senate would not agree, kunwari po, inimbitahan namin sila but they did not go there, or probably 2 or 3 only of them came in, and so hindi po represented ang Constituent Assembly. So there will be no time at all that we will be utilize that particular mode of amending the Constitution by simply for the Senate to refuse to go with us and meet with us as a Constituent Assembly. Wala pong mangyayari, at yung pong napakahalagang provision na itinakda ng gumawa ng saligang batas para susugin ang saligang batas ay hindi po mangyayari kahit kailan. The House of Representatives will be at the mercy of the Senate. Kasi sasabihin lang po nila, wala po kaming 3/4, sir. I'm sorry. And this has been the case. I have been long enough in Congress to see that our invitations were not even responded to. Wala pong nangyari. The Senate, with all due respect, sat on all the invitations. RBH1, RBH2, whatever RBH. Wala pong mangyayari. Siguro po, sa akin lang palagay, pag sinabi niyang 3/4 of all the members of Congress, we get the totality of the members. Halimbawa po, ngayon po ay 309 ang members ng House of Representatives, there are 24 members of the Senate. We have 333, three-fourths of that is 249, I think. So sabi po ng ating mga kaibigan sa Senate, madadilute naman kami. Tama naman po yun eh. 300 po kami, 24 sila. But that is the simple language of the Constitution. Yun po yung sinabi. Alam ka naman pong yung 300 ay lulunurin ng isang timbang tubig, Mr. Justice. So kailan po mangyayari talaga? It will not even be in the foreseeable future. Maybe we will wait for all eternity para lang po mapapayag namin ang aming mga kaibigan from the Senate to meet with us. Mag-uusap lamang po kami, hindi po mangyayari. Just the invitation. Wala pong mangyayari para pag-usapan namin whether we will vote separately or jointly. But in my own personal opinion, kasi po, hindi po kami gagawa ng batas. When we join ourselves as a constituent assembly, we are not making legislative function. We're not doing legislative function. In the same manner, in Section 18, Article 7, kapag ka po i-revoke natin ang proclamation ng martial law, sabi po ng article, Congress voting jointly by a vote of at least a majority of all its members. Ganon din po yung pagkakasabi. Why? Wala pong legislation involved doon. When we propose an amendment to the Constitution, we are simply a member of the Constituent Assembly. Kaya nga po, iraratify po ng ating mamamayan through a plebiscite. In Section 19, last paragraph of Article 7, sinabi, when the President shall have the power to grant amnesty with the consensus of a majority of all the members of Congress. That is not legislative. Kaya po pwede po yung joint eh. Nangyayari lang po yung bicameral pag gagawa po kami ng batas. Tama po yung sinabi ni Majority Leader Joel Villanueva. Magpapalit po kami ng kalye. Legislation po yun eh. So magbabaycam po yun. In this case, we are not doing legislative function. We are simply proposing an amendment to the Constitution. That is a constituent power. Ginagamit po namin, that is not legislative. Ang totoo po nun, ang mag-a-approve naman po ng aming proposal, yun pong mga mamamayan natin. Siguro po, Madam Chair, it is a respectful request for everybody to consider na baka naman po hindi separate voting talaga. Kasi po, ang totoo niyan, yung gumawa po ng saligang batas, Madam Chair, kung gusto po niyang i-distinguish, isa na lamang po, sabi po nila, katulad po nung Section 11, last paragraph, Article 7, kung gusto po nung gumawa ng saligang batas na i-distinguish talaga, joint voting, joint assembly, ganito po sinasabi, Section 11, paragraph, last paragraph, Article 7. Congress determines by two-thirds vote of both houses voting separately, tingnan po ninyo, of both houses voting separately that the President is unable to discharge the powers of his duties. Dinidistingi po niya eh. Section 9, Article 7. In case of a vacancy in the office of the Vice President, the President's nominee from the Senate or House of Representatives shall assume office upon confirmation of a majority vote of all the members of both houses voting separately. So, Madam Chair, may pagkakataon po sa buhay ng ating saligang batas kung minsan sasabihin niya na ididistingi niya voting jointly or in joint assembly, voting separately. But in this case po, napansin ko, pagka po hindi tayo gumagawa ng batas, if we are not in a legislative work, ang sinasabi po ng gumawa ng saligang batas, it is simple, the totality of all the members of Congress. Kaya tingin ko po doon, joint voting. Salamat po, Madam Chair.
Maraming salamat, Congressman Marcoleta. Nagmamadali po tayo dahil may session pa kami ng alas tres. Pero huling hirit yata kay sa ating mga justices, kung may maidadagdag po kayo, si Justice Tony Carpio, nagtaas po ng kamay. Perhaps you can enlighten us on what actually was envisioned by both the framers of the Constitution as well as the ponentes of the relevant cases. Justice Carpio, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The Constitution expressly provides that Congress shall consist of the House of Representatives and the Senate, period. It does not say that Congress, when performing legislative functions, shall consist of the House and Senate. So Congress is composed of the Senate and the House regardless of what they do, whether performing legislative function or approving the declaration of martial or doing other things. No? But in the declaration of martial law, they have to meet, but the Constitution says voting jointly. It's the only instance in the Constitution that you can find the phrase voting jointly. In other words, this is an exceptional case. That's why if you add voting jointly in another provision, that is an exceptional case that departs from the general rule that the Congress shall be composed of the House and the Senate. Vote, and when they are, when one chamber cannot act without the approval of the other, you cannot even pass a law renaming a national road if it is an act of the House alone. You cannot pass an ordinary law without both chambers approving. And the Constitution is the highest law of the land. You cannot just say the Speaker alone shall convene the Constituent Assembly and you need only 255 votes that will all come from the House and you can disregard the 24 votes of the Senate. That is an exceptional departure. That is a revision. So you cannot do that in a people's initiative. You can do that in a CONCON or a CONAS. I want to emphasize again, the Constitution is the highest law of the land. If you pass an ordinary law, both chambers must approve. And therefore, when you amend the highest law of the land, subject to ratification, you must also both approve. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Madam Chair, I made the qualification
I'm sorry, but I think we're short for time.
Maski na 1 minute lang, Madam Chair, because you know, this is very, very important. Ang sinabi ko
yes,
po kanina, kino-qualify ko.
But may I thank Justice Carpio for coming to the Senate.
Yes, ma'am.
And enlightening us with his extraordinary perspective and participation in all that yes. Past in our history. So, yes, Congressman Marcoleta, we have session.
I made a qualification, Madam Chair, na kapag ang Congress po ay nagsanib para sa Constituent Assembly, hindi po kami gagawa ng batas. Wala po yon. Tingnan po ninyo, Justice Carpio, Section 3, Article 11. The House of Representatives shall have the exclusive power to initiate all the case of impeachment. Hindi bicameral po yon, kami lamang po yon. Yung constitutional, yung commission on appointments, this is an independent body enshrined in the Constitution. Hindi po ang gawain namin po doon ay gumawa ng batas. We are there to evaluate and test the competence and the merits of the appointees of the President. Wala po kaming ginagawang batas doon. That is why doon po voting jointly kami. And we are members of a constituent body. As nasabi po rin CA. Hindi po ba? Pagka po nagkaroon ng trial sa Senate, pagka po yung impeachment, hindi po kami, ang Senate lang po is the sole trier. Nakalagay din po sa Constitution, that is not even bicameral. When a treaty or international agreement shall be valid and effective if concurred in by at least two-thirds of all the members of the Senate, hindi po kami kasali doon. That is not bicameral.
Po. I think I have to terminate the hearing.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you
very much. We have only one room, and this is the session hall. So, unfortunately, we'll have to wind this down. I guarantee you there will be other hearings, and you will be duly invited. For the representatives from the other groups, we can invite you at the next hearing. I'm so sorry we have not been able to accommodate all those from DSWD, DOH, DOLE, who were very well prepared to testify. I thank Pirma for coming over. We thank the legal luminaries who have graced us with their presence, and certainly the full force of the COMELEC that's represented here.
Madam Chair.
Is very welcome. Yes, Senator
One last request. Madam Chair,
and majority leader.
If the chair may also invite on behalf of the committee, Christian Monsod, also a framer of the 1987 Constitution and a former COMELEC chair, to the next hearing, Madam Chair.
Okay, yeah.
Madam Chair.
Yes,
just a very leader, quick, just a very quick reaction.
Senator Poe is back. Would you like to add?
Oh, yeah, no.
Okay, majority leader, please.
Thank you. I just can't help but make a short comment, Mr. Madam Chair, because I was listening to a press conference that is now going on with the other house, and some of our counterparts were saying that we should not be doing or conducting this investigation, which I don't feel is proper, Mr. President, Madam Chair. I think it should be noted that a lot of government funds were used, a lot of videos and even recordings, text messages, etc. Yung nakita natin. Sana lahat po tayo on board dito bilang mga kawani ng pamahalaan. Maging interesado tayo kung ginagamit yung pangalan natin, ginagamit yung opisina natin. Sana maging interesado tayo doon sa katotohanan na mayroong mga instances, Madam Chair, na yung naghihirap, naghihikahos na kababayan natin, humihingi ng tulong sa gobyerno, ipagkakait yung tulong kung hindi pipirma. Nakakasalukasok po yun. Kahit sinong Pilipino, hindi dapat baliwalayin yun. And that's the main reason, Madam Chair, that's why we are conducting this hearing. But on another note, because my good friend, our good friend, the brilliant lawyer from the House, Senator Congressman Marcoleta mentioned my name, I think it is clear for our people when we get elected as members of the Senate or the House of Representatives, it's very clear, Madam Chair, that we are not only being tasked to legislate laws. We are tasked even to exercise our mandate, to exercise our oversight function in ensuring the checks and balances exist. May nag-check, may nagmamatsyag, may nagbabantay sa executive, maging sa budget ng judiciary, dumadaan ho sa Kamara at dito sa Senado. Yung pagpapalit kanina ng kalye, paborito nating example yan, idinadaan sa Kamara, idinadaan sa Senado. Ito pa kayang pagpapalit ng kaluluwa ng bayan? Isang boto lang? Ibig sabihin, yung bumoto doon sa Batanes na 7,000 votes lang, congressman ka na, versus ang pinakamababang senador na na-elect, 15 million votes. Pareho lang yung boto nila. Ganun ba talaga 'yon yung intention ng framers of our constitution? So I just wanted to put that on record, Madam Chair, and again appeal to our colleagues, to our counterpart, na hindi po biro itong nangyaring peking initiative na ito. Marami pong nagrereklamo, tao ho, humihinga, naghihingi ng tulong sa gobyerno, nagdarahop, dinadanglil yung AX, pag hindi ka pumirma, hindi kita bibigyan. We should all be united on this matter, Madam Chair, na i-reject natin ito, siguruhing panagutin kung sino man ang nasa likod nito. Maraming salamat, Madam Chair.
Maraming salamat, Majo. At ngayon, para panghuli, at At narito ang ating kaibigan, Senator Grace Poe, nakasamahan ko sa pag-aamyenda ng economic limitations na nasa ating saligang batas through the provision of law. Senator Poe.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Gusto ko lang malaman din ng ating mga kababayan sapagkat ang kanilang itinutulak ay economic provisions di umano sa pagbalangkas ng pagbabago sa saligang batas. Katulong din ng House of Representatives, ang Senado ay nanguna upang ipasa ang tatlong napakahalagang mga batas na nag-aamyenda ng mga provision para sa ekonomiya. Unang-una na po ang Public Service Act na napakatagal na po, lagpas 80 years old na yata yung batas na yan. Pangalawa ang Trade Liberalization Act na pinangunahan ng ating minority leader. At pangatlo, ang Foreign Investments Act na pinangunahan naman ni Senator Aimee. Lahat po yan ay nakatutok sa pag-amyenda ng economic provisions. Hindi naman pag-amyenda, kundi pag-clarify ng economic provisions sa ating batas. Katulad sa Public Service Act, ngayon liberalized na po ang mga bagay katulad ng telco. Kaya pumasok ang yung SpaceX ni Elon Musk. Para dun sa mga malalayong lugar, meron tayong service. Niliberalize din dyan ang transportation except dun sa public utility vehicles sa mga jeep. At kasama na rin dyan pati na rin yung mga trains. So kung may mag-i-invest para dito sa atin. So hindi po totoo na pagdating dito sa economic ay may problema tayo na kailangan. Meron kulang. Maaari, pero ito po, yung mga major ones ay nagawa na natin. Kung meron mang dapat ayusin ay ang pagtutol ng ilan sa Supreme Court dito sa Public Service Act. Siguro pwedeng magsama ang Kongreso, Senado at mga mamamayan na doon natin resolbahan sa Supreme Court itong ibang kakulangan sa provision ng ekonomiya. Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat at nagpapasalamat ako muli sa partisipasyon ng lahat ng dumalo. At asahan po ninyo, marami pa tayong tatawagin yung Attorney Tony Abad. Abangan natin pagdating sa Pilipinas, ang Change Philippines at yung mga binanggit ng mga testigo mula sa Bukidnon. At inaabangan pa rin natin kay Mr. Noel Oñate yung donors list at kalakip nun yung iba't iba pang hiningi ng ating kasamahan mula sa COMELEC na mga papeles at dokumento na nagkaklarifika ng proseso ngayon sa mga pirma na naibigay na at ang gagawin sa mga petisyon na hinaharap. Maraming salamat po sa inyong lahat, higit sa lahat sa dalawang justice po natin, Justice Carpio and Justice Ascuna. Thank you. And with that, this committee hearing is hereby suspended.